Snow Patrol and Run on XFM 104.9. I'm Ricky Gervais. With me is Stephen Merchant and Carl Bilkins. Yep. That's three for one. I don't know. All right?
Exciting. Exciting.
News. Breaking news is that there's only two more weeks of us before we have to go away on a little extended break again. So, can't give any more details yet. We don't know when we can come back because, we don't know what we're doing. We're going to, America. We're doing the Golden Globes and then we're going to watch the Office pilot being filmed.
Yes.
And then we've got bits, I'm doing a bit of a tour. So it'll be sort of the summer times, probably.
Yeah.
I'm saying it like they care.
Oh, they don't give a damn.
Do you know what I mean? I sometimes think that because, you think, oh, you don't want to let down the people, you want to keep it consistent, you want to give, you know, but really, I know I like doing this more than anyone listening.
Definitely.
Do you know what
definitely,
I mean?
Definitely.
I love coming in, I love squeezing Carl's head.
Yeah.
I love playing some records. You know, I like sort of sitting in the room with you. I know you love it.
Oh.
I can't wait.
I can't think of anything else I'd rather be doing on a Saturday.
Yeah. So, we got our Saturdays back though.
Yeah, that'd be great.
I mean, my alarm went off today and I was a bit tired because we had a couple of drinks last night, didn't we?
Last night, yeah.
We had, you know, we're party animals. Oh, I've been looking for an office this week, as you know. And it's so stressful. Just walking around, just talking to agents and, right, okay. So, my method is this, right? I walk around the area that I want to be an office in because I don't want to hear anything else. I don't want to, you know what I mean? So I walk around, to be fair, it is about a square 500 yards.
Yeah.
Right?
It's sort of- Your house is in the center.
Yeah. And, so I walk around and look at placards. I go, that's a nice office. And I phone them up. There's loads of different people I'm dealing with, right? And they went, oh, we got one in so-and-so street. I think it was Fifth Street or something like that. I went, oh yeah, I went along to, I'll see you there in 20 minutes. I got there. You were there, if you remember. I looked around and I said to Steve, it looks alright, isn't it? No pawn shops or anything like that, right? And Steve went, well, it is next to a brothel. And I looked, and there on the next thing, like, you know, model, first floor, Susie, 03, and I phoned him and I said, do you know what? Don't bother coming here. No, I said, no, because it's next to a brothel. He went, yeah. I went, right, okay. Just for future reference, I don't want an office literally next to a brothel, right? When I go to work, I don't want to walk past prostitutes. Call me old-fashioned.
Yeah,
right?
As you're going into work, there's a prostitute. Yeah. Morning.
Oh, she's got a cappuccino. Yeah, Starbucks, yeah. business good? Yeah, it's a bit slow at the moment. It picks up later this evening, does it really? Good. Yeah. And, I said to him, I've got so my New Year's resolution is being like a little fascist when it comes to business. And I said, also future reference, no crack dens and no wild animals in the porch. And, I just can't believe it. There's always something wrong. We went to one, right? It got there, right? And, a woman said, oh, I'm new here. She didn't know what keys she was using. And she went, it's the third floor. And she went, no, no point, we won't both get in the lift. I went, right, will you get a desk in the lift? Right? She went, I've got a chair in the lift before. Brilliant. So,
yeah.
Just find me an office, Rathbone Place, sort of Percy Street, Charlotte Street, Dean Street.
Yeah.
Yeah. First or second
floor. I'm worried we're going to get emails from estate agents, phone calls from them. You know what those people are like.
But right? I don't look at emails.
True. Fair enough.
So, play a record.
Sexist. Joe Jackson, different for girls.
Well, he's not in the charts anymore.
Oh, I can't believe it.
Unbelievable. You were talking about renting an office. I'm a little bit intimidated because I'm just at the moment thinking about trying to buy a flat or something because
sure.
I'm just tired of pissing money down the drain.
I know. Yeah.
And, but I'm really petrified. I've put it off and put it off because I'm really gullible. I'm just, when I'm confronted with anyone in a suit who sort of knows what they're talking about, they can sell me anything, I'm intimidated, it's like, you know how you're supposed to go in there and you're supposed to sort of act like you're the guy with the money, you're the, this is what I want, this is what I want, no. But I go in there and it's like I'm afraid they're gonna say, clear off, I don't wanna sell your house, I'm not
yeah.
interested.
Have you ever thought of like, really putting on sort of like some sort of cool air? Like, sort of like kicking the door and going, what was that? Is it like, you'd be found out in 30 seconds,
yeah,
wouldn't you?
Exactly.
You'd go in there, you'd stub your toe, and they go, what are you kicking like off your toe, off your toe?
Exactly, yeah.
Brilliant.
Just tapping the walls.
Yeah, tapping the wall. What's the rates on? What rates? I don't know.
Well, this is, do you remember, I don't know if I told you before, I wanted to buy a laptop computer, yeah. And everyone said, go up Tottenham Court Road, and I was reading, like, magazines, and they were saying, haggle, make sure you haggle, make sure you got, you're planning to haggle, get the best deal you can, and I found a shop which was selling the computer I wanted, and I went in there, and I had this whole plan in my mind of what was going to happen. He was going to say, like, it's worth this, I'm going to go, yeah. Well, look, I can get it cheaper here, I want to buy it from you, I'm going to haggle, da-da. And off I went. So I went in the shop, and I said, yeah, looking for this, interest in this Toshiba. How much is it? He went, oh, it's 1500 quid. I went, sure, sure. Okay. I said, I'll give you 1300. He went, it's 1500. And I said, sure, but I'm willing to give you 1300. He went, 1500. And I was done already because he hadn't even begun to haggle. Well, I was assuming he'd at least go 1400 and we could start, but nothing. So now I was screwed. My whole plan went out the window.
Yeah. What did you do? Just leave?
No, I said to him, I said, the thing is, I can get this computer cheaper down the road, but, you know, I like what you're providing me. I like your service. I've had good stuff about you. It was amazing. I said, I've heard good stuff about you. And he went, I said, seriously, I can walk down the street, I can buy it there for cheap for like 1400. And he went, well, see you later then. And I was like, right. So I walked out the place. I said, well, I'm gonna have to leave then. And I walked out the place, and of course I wanted to get it from there because it was still the cheapest. So I had to walk back in again. I went, yeah. I've just had some second thoughts. Listen, I'll tell you what. I'll pay the 1500. Can I get a free carry case? He went, the carry case is free anyway. I said, I'll take it.
Carry case is nothing. No, but how much would you charge for that if it was on sale? Carry case, a tenner. Well, let's just say it is a tenner. Give it to me for free. And he went, no, it's a tenner. And you went, well, you said it was free a minute.
Yeah. Oh, it's just pathetic.
That is lovely.
It's having to walk out making a big statement and then come back in again.
Oh, dear.
So I'm really scared. I feel like I need someone to come with me and do all the talking. You know what they're talking about. Cause I'm not gonna be able to tell if there's subsidence or if there's damp or-
No, but you don't do that.
Don't I? Is that not my responsibility?
No, you get a survey done.
Sure.
And they charge for that and then the- Yeah, you don't have to go around doing it yourself.
Right. Could I make a saving if I did it myself?
Yeah, this should be alright. Yeah. There's a hole in the wall, Steve.
Yeah.
Yeah, but what's a hole in the wall?
Put some newspaper
in that. In Chaucer's day, that was the toilet. That'd be fine. Carl, you're a second time buyer, aren't you? But
yeah. Bought one in Manchester. Lost £7,000 on that one.
Well, don't buy in Manchester.
No, it's a good flat, it's just it wasn't- I didn't buy it to sort of make money, I thought I was going to be living there like all my life. And then a job came up here, and it was like, oh.
You bought your first flat in Manchester, you assumed you would be living there for the rest of your life.
Well, I wasn't in a rush.
Play a record, you're an idiot.
Hang on a minute, so have you got a property portfolio? Have you got the two houses, Nick?
No, I've got rid of that one.
Oh, you sold that one?
Got this flat.
£7,000
loss. Got this flat. I'll tell you something that is interesting.
Hold on, though.
What?
£7,000 lost. It was a flat in Manchester, but it could only cost about £8,000 anyway.
Right, Steve, something they do now, right, they've got to do by law when you're buying, right? I was looking at one in London, right? It's haunted. They've got to tell you now.
Right, don't talk shit.
I'm telling you now.
Record.
I'm telling you now.
Yeah, yeah. There's no such thing as ghosts. That is ridiculous if that appears on a legal document.
Right, if there's anyone who sells flats and that, does that for a living.
Yeah.
Right, email in. Because yeah. I'm telling you now, that is a fact. She sort of dropped it in. She said, I said, oh, you know, nice feel there. And she said, yeah, well, that'll be the ghost. Just dropped it in, that's all they've got to do. And then I was like, what? And I went, oh, yeah.
That's all I've got to do, is it? So that's the legal thing. Did you drop it in? So in court, you go, did you drop it in? Yeah, I dropped it in. Play a record, you're an idiot.
That's David Gray and This Year's Love, if you're in love. I hope it lasts. It's only January.
What you got for us,
Steve? Just thought we ought to maybe go through some of the emails. I mean, I don't want to query the caliber of some of the emails we get sent on this show, but, here's a typical one, Rick.
Go on.
There's no name, it's just from Glicko, that's his email address. That's just a question to you, Rick. Did I see you walking around Marylebone High Street last Sunday?
Yes.
Okay.
Well, I don't know.
Well, I
was in Marylebone High Street last Sunday, yeah.
Yeah, but did you see Glicko?
I didn't see Glicks. Okay. I didn't see the Glickster,
Alright, this is one from M. Ricky, what do you think of Richard Bacon's show? I can't decide if he's better than you.
Nor can I.
Any thoughts?
Nor can I. I can't help her out on that one.
Sure.
That's a really personal thing. She's got to dig deep. She's got to look at both of us. She's got to find out what she likes.
Yeah.
And then whether I provide more of that than Baker's.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, Baker Foyle's brilliant.
Yeah.
I'm not going to put myself up against him. So, I can't have you. Next, Steve, next.
Well, there was a lot of emails last week, which were saying how much they enjoyed the Christmas specials. Thank you very much for that. That's very flattering of you. There was also a couple. There was one that it was a guy, I'm sorry that I think I might have deleted it, but oh, I should have sent a reply, because there was a guy from Canada saying, if there any chance you're around in March, whether you could pop in and have a surprise birthday dinner for his wife.
Oh, God, why do you keep that?
I can't let it go now, can I,
you idiot?
So, okay. I really apologise for that.
Yeah.
There's also, this is interesting, this is more for Carl, really. It seems unlikely.
Is it from a doctor saying you're an idiot?
We've got plenty of those, I tend to delete them.
Okay, right, yeah. Look at his face!
No, it just says, you know, don't like to complain, but I won the film competition about 5 or 6 weeks ago, and I haven't received my prizes.
Oh dear, that's all Carl has to do on the show. We provide the chat, the records, the light entertainment. I mean,
glamour.
Strokes of comedy genius. All Carl has to do is send out the prizes and say, there was a monkey that was a bank robber at 5 to 3.
Yeah. What's
Carl?
Excuse, Carl?
Do you remember her winning? I've got all-
Well, you're calling her a liar?
Well, I am, because I don't remember ever seeing-
Right, he's calling her a liar.
So, Joanne Ogden, you're claiming, is just making this up. She sent this in on a whim, trying to fool us and get some cheap tat.
Wow.
I don't believe that. I don't believe anyone would lie to try and get Knowing Me, Knowing You on VHS. I really don't.
Well, I'll look in the records because we keep all the details, so, you know what I mean?
Right. Well, one of you's in the wrong, and do you know what? Knowing you, Carl, I don't think it's Joanne.
No. Has anyone else ever emailed in saying they haven't got the,
Lenderton?
Tiger Trap? No, they haven't. They haven't.
Well, yeah, so one mistake's one too far, because that's one person, so, you know, you might send out 30, but that one person, that's the first time they've won a competition, they want the history of Wind, narrated by Donald McIntyre, on VHS,
yes.
And, you know...
Stephen King's It, on Betamax.
Yeah, yeah. No, to mind that sometimes they want the best of Primal Scream on a cassette.
Exactly.
So, you know.
Got to make sure you're sending these ones.
Yeah.
Final email from Andy. He says, the webcam, is pointing at the ceiling. Is it because the air conditioning vent is more exciting than what happens on the show?
Let's put that down now.
That's absolutely right.
Hold on a minute. Now. Just, if someone, is that good?
People love the webcam. I don't know what they're interested in, because all they get is a picture of Carl's big head.
It's not a big, it's just round.
Oh. Get it right.
Yeah.
Carl, I'd like you to play the next tune. I got sent a little cheeky, primer for The Cure's Join the Dots. It's B-sides and rarities. Lots of stuff from them. From all over the ages. And it's amazing how good their B-sides are. Here's one of them playing. Cure. And that's called A Man Inside My Mouth, which was the B-side to Close to Me. There's nothing amusing about that, Rex. I don't know why you're laughing.
Wow.
It's called A Man Inside My Mouth.
Yeah, I know.
And that's fine.
Yeah, it's like, you know, this, like, you know, the little man inside your head.
Yeah. You know, if a man wants to be inside anyone's mouth, that's good, you know, good option.
What?
There's nothing wrong with that.
But I agree.
Yeah.
Carl, do you agree with that?
What man in your head? What does that mean?
It's brilliant. Yeah.
It's extraordinary.
He doesn't even understand schoolboy carry-on innuendo.
Amazing.
I know the fact that the play on words is too far then. What does it mean on sight of the erection? What? What do you mean, dumplings? Huh?
You're a fan of The Simpsons. You know that character in The Simpsons, the, gap-toothed yokel?
Yeah.
If I look at Carl when he's the black, Cletus.
It's
the kind of cliche comic book thing of having a mouth wide open to suggest scornlessness. Oh. It's amazing.
Or an accommodating come on.
Yes. Absolutely.
Carl. That little man inside your head, it's what, you know, people use it as your conscience, don't they?
Alright.
Have you ever heard that before?
No.
Okay.
I was, Rick, I was watching Moonraker. It was on, I think it was last week.
Yeah.
I don't know how familiar you are with the James Bond films.
I don't think I've ever watched a Bond film from beginning to end.
Yeah.
I've never watched one on DVD, and I've never gone to cinema to watch one, and I'm not usually in on Easter Saturday.
Exactly.
Honestly.
Well, the thing about James Bond, when I was younger, I thought he was amazing. I just thought he was the ultimate cool, sophisticated hero. Do you know what I mean? My dream as a kid, like when I say kid, I mean a teenager, was to come home, which invariably he did. He'd come back to his hotel suite, he'd open the door, there'd be a trail of clothes, and he'd follow it, go into the bedroom, and there'd be a beautiful woman in the bed, you know.
He'd have said, clean up, what are you doing? You're messy.
I'll never forget my mum to clean all this up now.
She's got a bad back.
There's a nudie lady in my bed. and as I say, I used to think he was really cool and sophisticated, and it's only of late that I've sort of watched, he's revisited these films, and
It's, I tell you what, it's his jokes.
Oh.
He is the most infuriating man ever.
Absolutely.
I mean, I don't know why people in the films consider him so, I mean, I think the reason that women in the films are always being seduced by him is because if you notice, they normally got English as a second language.
Right.
So they don't understand, so when he's making those jokes.
So they don't know when he goes, just keeping the British end up.
Yeah, I'm just attempting re-entry.
Yeah.
If that was a British woman, she'd be going, what?
Don't say that. That sounds awful and it's a terrible pun,
Roger.
It's
so lewd. What am I?
Yeah, what am I? Yeah. And they just laugh.
They just laugh coquettishly and then, you know, unzip their dress normally. Yeah. But some of the guys, there was one where he's being chased by a guy in a moped or something, and the guy plummets off a cliff and smashes through a van which is full of feathers, and he plummets to his death, and Bond just says, all those feathers, and he still couldn't fly. What are you talking about? What do you mean it's not a joke? It's just words. There's one where in Moonraker, he punches this guy, he's having a fight, he punches him through a plate glass window, and he lands on a piano, and Bond goes, play it again, Sam. I remember there's the one in one of the early films where he throws a guy in the bath and electrocutes him by throwing in a thing. And then he goes, absolutely shocking. But I was thinking, you've just killed a man.
I know.
You're a psychopath.
Yeah.
It's just so excruciating. If someone was doing those kind of jokes in the office, you would hate them. Do you know what I mean? You wouldn't want to talk to them. They'd be a bore.
I know, yeah. Everything's a little one-liner. I know. And everything's a pun.
Yeah.
But I'll tell you what, there is a bloody good secret agency.
That's true.
So, you know, they're not hired for their, you know, wit and, stand-up ability.
Exactly.
So, you know, it swings and roundabouts.
Yeah.
I doubt Johnny Vegas could, save the world.
That's true enough, yeah.
So, think on different people, different needs. Kings of Leon, California Waiting on XFM 104.9. Do you know what, Steve? We get emails and, you know, we got our posters up around this show and, people enjoy it. But I don't think we get the credit we deserve for picking the music.
It's true.
Because we're totally unplaylisted, and I don't know if people know about this, that mine and Steve's sort of first passion before comedy is probably music. We're really, really, we love playing each other sort of records and that. And maybe when we come back, we should do a show where there is no pressure to, you know, like Carl doesn't press the buttons for us, pre-record it, where we just swap each other's sort of ideas for music.
It'd be like the Ricky Gervais compilation tape.
Well, sort of like, we're not talking John Peel where we try and find obscure Belgian jungle and do demos. You know, everything from, you know, Kings of Leon, Lou Reed, you know, maybe a bit of 80s stuff that people have forgotten about.
Beautiful songs.
So what do you think?
I'd love to do that, Rick. I mean, genuinely, there's nothing more exciting to me than introducing to someone a song which they then go on and they love and they listen, they buy the album,
But that's something to think about, maybe, for later.
Yeah. Well, it's like you say, the pressure to kind of come up with some, you know, high-caliber chat between each record, it takes a toll.
But, that's, you know, it's a passion of ours and we'd love to, but now, it's Rockbusters.
Can I just say something now, before we do Rockbusters? A lot of people sort of, they come up to me, they say, Steve, we like the show, when are you going to get rid of Rockbusters? It brings it down. I'm not joking, there is loads of people.
Come off it.
I know people who say, you're never going to stop that, are you? So, one of us is lying again.
Well, not really. I'm talking about people who've listened to the show. You're talking about Suzanne, your girlfriend.
Oh, Martin. He'll be at home now with a pad, getting ready to play.
But I should just-
Martin Freeman did encourage Carl on a couple of occasions. He even tried to get him through with the answer, egg, when we were doing that naming animal round.
Yes.
So-
But I should just say that people think that somehow Ricky and I are endorsing Rockbusters, that somehow by allowing it on the show, somehow we think it's good and we appreciate it. And I need to point out that it's more like when a child comes back from school and they've done a painting.
Yeah.
It's crap.
Yeah.
But of course you've got to stick it on the fridge.
The cat is bigger than the house.
You've got to stick it on the fridge because otherwise the kids going to get upset.
In this next episode, you've got to remember the cat is bigger than the house.
Exactly.
Okay.
It doesn't look like anything.
The humans don't have bodies, their legs come straight from their head.
Yeah. Mummy and daddy.
Please welcome to the stage, Carl Pilkington's Rockbusters.
Alright. Right, so, cryptic clues, no, initials, cryptic. And you work it out, and you email in and that.
Yeah.
First one.
Yeah.
Don't be stealing my tools, take your sister's. Alright, and the initials NK.
Don't be stealing my tools, take my sister's.
Yeah, so that's like the cryptic clue, and the initials of the artist or band is NK, alright? Second one. Buy it if you want, not bothered, think about it. Come back, right? Come back if you want.
Start again, Carl! I lost halfway through! Right, start that second one again!
Right, well, you can buy-
Different Well, the first one was, bite it. Well, no, now this one was, yeah, well, write it down, bite. Right, do it. Do it. If it's a cryptic clue, all the letters count. Do it.
Buy it if you want, I'm not that bothered. You know, think about it, come back, check some other places out first before you, you know.
In the Times! So we've got no time for other clues.
Right. So that's SC.
Right, do that clue again.
Buy it if you want. I'm not fussed, do you know what I mean? Think about
fussed.
It.
Fussed! Fussed has made an appearance! Fussed wasn't there before! Do the clue again. Do the clue again!
Initials SC for that one.
Do the clue again.
I don't want to do it again.
Do you haven't finished it yet?
I have, that's it.
No, do the clue again.
Do
the clue again.
Buy it if you want, I'm not fussed, right? Chop around. Come back. It's up to you. I'm not pushing you into anything.
It's up to you, wasn't there?
SC for that one, right? And the final one, that's good, I can play 10-pin bowling again.
Okay, what's the clue?
That's O.
O.
O. Alright, so,
okay, now I assume that, I'm not gonna bother to look, but I assume there's a jiffy bag of tacks which people can win. Alright, well great, good luck. Ricky.Gervais@xfm.co.uk is the email address.
Thorns?
No, bye, if you want, I'm not fussing, come back, have a look around. I'm open Wednesdays, by the way, I should have thought of
that. Thorns and No Blue Sky, off their album, of last year, which is probably my favourite album of the year. I've started getting into that sort of like music, more serious thing, in case we do it.
I mean, I don't know, from that comment, maybe we should do some preparation.
Pre-record it?
Yeah.
So we can sort of like, cut all the ums and ahs and,
like that
and me sort of like, eating a sandwich while it's on, singing along, tapping a little bit, yeah. I won't lay down like this either. We'll get me a chair that I can sort of be upright so I can enunciate.
You weren't in there, were you, when Carl was singing along to Oliver's Army?
No.
It was a joy. Checkpoint Charlie. Oliver's Army. No idea.
Oh, bless him. No, Rockbusters, well on the way. Any right answers yet, Carl?
Let's just check. Let me see, we got one email.
One email?
No.
No, because they probably don't make sense.
Yeah, no responses whatsoever.
There's still on the text, isn't that?
Really?
83XFM, if you want to do it on the old,
speak up, Carl. We're on the radio, we're live.
Just letting you know, do it on the text if you want. Send it in on the text.
And what? Well, what is it? Say it!
83XFM.
Right.
Right.
What's the email address again?
Ricky.Gervais@xfm.co.uk.
Are you tired today, Carl? Are you just bored, or?
No, I'm alright, I'm good.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Steve.
Yeah, well, no, I just wanted to mention to you, I went to, a pub near my house recently. I found out that there was a pool hall. Like a pool club there. And I love pool, I like to think of myself as looking a little bit like Paul Newman in The Hustler.
Yeah.
When I'm shooting pool. Yeah. And, I went down there, and I went with my flatmate, and, it's quite a seedy pub, in many respects. There's a lot of weird people in there, like, alcoholics, and—
Why'd they go there?
It's strange, isn't it?
Weird, isn't it? Go on.
And, very, very odd people. And, so he's a little bit nervous. And he says, I'm a bit worried, because there's a lot of kind of, you know, there's people from the estate. The nearby council estate, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
For want of a better word, scum. You know. And, so he's a bit edgy. And, bizarrely, because I so wanted to play pool, I said to him, he went, I'm a bit scared about going in. I went, don't worry, you're with me.
Yeah.
I don't know what I was thinking, I don't know what that means. They're gonna think, well, wait a minute, the 6 foot guy with the lanky guy with the glasses, I'm not gonna mess with him.
There you go, there, they take your glasses off and you go, I've lost.
Exactly.
That's it, I'm out of here.
This is why I've never got into a fight, because if my glasses are gone, I'm screwed. That's the first
thing. You're really short sighted, aren't you?
I'd be absolutely done for.
And are you nervous without, are you sort of like nervous without them?
You know, whenever you see like a kind of action film or whatever, or maybe like a horror film,
the nerd loses
glasses and he's scrabbling around on the floor
while
the dinner coming behind him. That's me.
Really?
Yeah, done for. Absolutely done for.
Well, what did you do when you were at school when you had to play tennis or football or rugby or something?
Kept them on.
That's dangerous.
Well, of course it is. That's why I was never, you know, as good at rugby as I probably could have been. You know, because of course you can. How can you play rugby with glasses on? I'm in the scrum going, careful! Your boots!
Hello! Yeah. Never mind me nads.
Exactly.
Watch my glasses!
But, so I went in, because I used to, I used to do judo when I was very young.
Well, that's impossible.
But this is ludicrous.
That must get falling off.
Oh, of course.
What about gaffer tape? Just sort of like round. Yeah, yeah.
Well, I bought something like a kind of a sports strap to keep them on, and they just pushed them right into my eyes. I could barely see. I was all blinded. But I swear, when I used to go to judo, I'm sure that the other kids were being taught, right, just knock Steve's glasses off. Knock his glasses off, you can get him.
And so I'm
always a bit edgy about fights, but for some reason I felt super confident going in there. I was like, I swaggered in, and into the pool hall, and it's one of those places you've got to sort of knock, it's like a speakeasy, you've got to knock, and they open the door and you come in.
Yeah.
And I'm in there, and my
one of those things you slide, like a little letterbox, you slide over, you knock knock, you put your face down, you just knocked your glasses off.
And so I went in there, and in a way, my flatmate was justified in being a little bit edgy, because the conversation we could overhear, the table next to us, we were playing pool, the guy next to us was going, yeah, of course, the bloody police. Spent Boxing Day in the nick. Absolute nightmare.
You're getting nervous.
So I was getting a little bit edgy, because I didn't know, but then I thought, you know, if they don't mess with their own, we're like, we're almost like gangsters ourselves, because we're there in the lion's den, do you know what I mean? We'll probably be fine. So then, there's just an old guy serving at the bar, you know, in his 50s, and some guys go over to the jukebox, some young kids, they're just hanging out in the pool hall, they're pretty cool, they put some money in the jukebox, and in first track, Coldplay, fine, I'm thinking that's nice, I'm playing pool, second track, hardcore German techno, and they put in about 50 quid's worth, it seemed, because it just went on, really thumping, kind of like GABA stuff, old guy at the bar, just nodding his head, cleaning the glass.
Yeah.
So into this,
piano player, furious.
Exactly. Into this comes, like, what appear to be a family of holidaymakers with kids. So they've entered this, like, CD pool hall, we've got, you know, the Cray twins playing pool next to me. They come in, the German techno's glaring, they come in, and there's, like, kids, you know, and they've got the baby in one of those little pouches, and they they sit down, and, the weirdest thing was one of the guys, the uncle, let's say, he picked up the kid, and he was about to put the baby down in a chair, and I thought, hang on, that's quite a hard-backed chair. And as he did it, the baby's head just went and hit the back of the chair, and I just flipped back and hit the back of the chair, because he just lumped it down.
Oh,
in
God!
Head. And it started screaming, it crying, you know, and the, teenagers were rocking to that, they loved it. And he came over, and it was transparent what had happened, and the mum was going, what's happened? The baby's crying. And he went, I don't know what happened. And I wanted to lean over and go, you lying swine!
You
know what happened? You just hear yourself. I wanted to go, just take her aside and say, never let him handle your baby again.
No, the head was wobbling around. I could see it coming.
I don't know, who knows, you might turn out like Carl now.
That's a point.
But what do you do in those situations? You know,
Well, I'm assuming, by the way you're taking it lightly, the baby wasn't hurt in any way. Well, then.
But it was still a big wreck.
You keep out of it, don't you? What are you going to do? Call the authorities and go, it was him.
Yeah, yeah. But I don't know. I mean, I don't want to name the place in case I get knifed.
But, I imagine you trying to swagger it when you overheard him drop the neck. I imagine you know me, yeah, pigs. Sorry? Yeah, I ate the pigs as well. No, I'm a lawyer. I was down there. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Sure. Sure. Oh dear.
But, so, I'll be going back there. So I feel like I'm
that's it.
There.
I mean, I've told you before, Steve, stay away from working class people and bad men in trainers. Because, you know, you hang around with nerdy wells and you're going to get your glasses knocked off.
That's true.
Jet. Rollover DJ on XFM 104.9. Carl. Now, Carl, you promised me that you were going to reintroduce Educating Ricky.
Yeah, we can do that.
Have you got it? Have you got something that will, that's something that I won't know that's correct and that will interest me?
Yeah, there's loads of stuff.
Is it anything to do with monkeys?
No, we've got monkey news.
We've got monkey news coming out, of course we have. Monkey news people, and they're now over to, XFM for monkey news with Carl Pilkington.
No, we're not doing that yet. Educating Ricky is-
Yeah. Well, let's do it.
We did it ages ago.
Educating Ricky. Oh, that's interesting, and it's correct.
Hang on a minute, though. What I do is, I tease you, don't I, with headlines.
Oh, go on, then.
And then you have to sort of go, that one sounds good.
Go on, then.
I want to know more about that. Educate me.
Yeah.
Right? Okay. You've got, well.
Oh, jeez. Oh.
That Nelly died.
That Nelly died. Oh, right,
okay. Okay. Right. Could be about an elephant. Yeah. Go on.
You've got that. You've got, well,
I got well. Take well for as red. So they all start with well. Okay.
Knob body has been that lucky before.
Brilliant. All right.
Okay.
Oh, you've got
get a lobe of this court case.
Right, okay. I'm going for nobody has been that lucky before.
Right, it's a story about this kid who was born, right?
Was he?
Yeah, he's popped out, like, and the dad and the mum saw the baby and it was like, oh, that's a good looking little kid.
Sure.
And they were proud and that. And then,
they're surprised that it's a good looking little kid, it's theirs.
Yeah.
Like, it could have been a frog, and they'd have gone, oh, he's got your eyes.
And then, the doctor goes, yeah, it is, but, look at that.
What?
He said, it's a boy, and, hasn't got a knob.
I love the doctor saying that. I love this GP.
Right.
Oh, this midwife saying that. Oh, I love your book, yeah? Yeah, but no knob, baby. Mr. and Mrs. I mean, think.
Right. No, but I'm speeding it up a bit.
All right, come on. So the baby's
like, so
born.
The baby's like that, and the doctor says that, and the woman's like, oh, it's our first as well, and stuff, right? She's really gutted.
What's the second gonna be like?
So,
no head. So
just a knob.
Doctor says, yeah.
They call it Carl.
Right, go on.
So the doctor says, well, I'll leave it with you for a bit, get used to the idea, right?
As opposed to throwing it away.
So he wanders off.
Yeah.
He comes back with a smile on his face. Right?
Found the knob.
So the mum and dad are like, what are you smiling about? He said, you're not going to believe this. Baby's just been born. It's got two. Right? You can have one of them. And they did a little, little operation.
Where did you get this information from?
That's in a book.
What book?
Is it the same as the book that you carry round with you?
No.
With the woman with three legs, the juggler with nine arms, and the bloke who found shagging a chicken under a rock. Is it in that book?
Well, weird though, isn't it?
Well, it's not true.
It is true.
What, in the same hospital, there was a baby born without a knob. Luckily, it's Carl.
What happened?
You swear to God, you're not making
the doctor came back smiling, because you won't believe it. There's a baby there with an excess of a knob.
It happened, honestly. I'm not, all these things are not made up, the educating stuff. That's why I do it, isn't it? Teaching you stuff, always teaching you stuff.
Alright, if anyone can confirm the baby with no knob,
they're gonna confirm it, because they're gonna go to the same dubious website that Carl got it from.
I always try to be level-headed and reasonable in these situations.
And it's always Guatemala or Mexico. Rodriguez was born without a knob. Luckily, baby next door, was one of two knobs. What a load of shite. Play a record.
There's still more to come.
Oh.
I'm looking forward to-
Was it Nelly? Nelly dead.
Nelly died.
Nelly died.
Bones. Radiohead off the Bends album.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, might be my favourite album of all time.
You said it before, yeah.
I
can't say I've ever really got into it. I remember when it came out, it was just so ubiquitous everywhere, I never really bothered listening
to it. I can still listen to it every day.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that might be sad, I don't know. But it's a fantastic album.
Yeah.
On XFM 104.9, just practicing for when we,
talk about music.
Talk more about music than maybe monkeys and people born without knobs, baby. Carl, any other thoughts?
Well, I'm not gonna tell you any more educating stuff yet.
You're gonna tease me with that, are you?
Leave you with, it Nelly died.
Yeah.
And get a load of this court case, right? But I want you thinking about-
Yeah, thinking about it, yeah, just getting my red juices ready.
Exactly.
Yeah, like an aperitif, yeah, sure. Yeah.
But, I've just educated you.
Yeah.
Right? And I watched The Office Christmas stuff on, last Sunday.
Did you enjoy it?
I think it was good.
Good.
I think it was good.
Thank you very much.
One of my favourites.
Really?
Second one's good.
Yeah, okay, your second one, more the payback's in the second one, the first one's more set up.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'd have thought people would like the second one more.
Yeah.
So that's nice. That's a nice critique, thank you, Carl.
But there was something in it you did about cavemen.
Cavemen?
You said something about, it was a fact about cavemen and you sort of only half did it. You didn't give the full information, like,
what?
Like I do in that. You just-
Where was it? What bit was it?
It was the bit when you were talking about getting a woman, I think, or you were talking about breasts or-
Oh, the one when I said people are- the reason women have cleavage is it reminds men of buttocks, because when we were cavemen we used to do you from behind.
Yeah.
Yeah. At the blind date, yeah.
Is that a joke or-
Well, I was hoping it was funny. We were- Oh, you mean, no, I don't know. Yeah, I think I did- I think cleavage is meant to represent, in a sort of Desmond Morris pop sort of anthropology type way, I think I've seen that before, that cleavage represents buttocks. And I imagine, you know, cavemen probably did do it from behind. I don't know what you want to know, Carl, really. It was, it's in a sitcom, it wasn't a documentary.
It looked like one.
Yeah. Wasn't. Brilliantly directed to look like one, I'll give you that.
Mm. No, but what you're saying, so blokes like...
Yeah, I think cleavage is represented like buttocks, because obviously buttocks were much more of a sexual organ. Evolutionary speaking, breasts were to actually bring up to suckle young, but and were a sign of sexual maturity, so you're ready to mate. But whereas Carl, I'm not an anthropologist, mate. I'm struggling here. What do you need to know?
But
yeah, I imagine that the cleavage reminds you of an arse.
Right. Well, if it's all about arse, why don't gays like a little bit of tip? No, do you know what I mean?
You done me! So the question put to us today on XFM 104.9, please call me $1, is if it's all about arse, then why don't gays like a little bit of tit?
I was worried.
If it's all about arse, why don't gays like tit? If it's all about arse, why don't gays like tit? Just call in with your. Thanks very much for tuning in. This has been Children's TV. If it's all about arse, why don't gays like tit?
It's still been an hour and a quarter before we got round to gays, so it's good to see Ray Payne's appearance.
If it's all about arse, why don't gays like a bit of tit? Is the question. What a brilliant question. Well, if you're an anthropologist or a psychologist, a doctor, a gay, please call in if it's all about arse. This is the question.
I'm not convinced by this whole, cleavage looks like an arse, that's
no, not at Steve,
I
nor
think,
am I. It's a bit of mock anthropology. I didn't think it would be under scrutiny.
I think it's more likely that the reason men find cleavage attractive is because they know there's a lovely pair of Bristols down there.
Yeah, so
it's like, ooh, here we are.
If that's what's on show.
Exactly, imagine what's down below.
If that's in the front window, right,
yeah, what's she got to go in the shop?
Oh, dear! The Coral, Bill McKay on XFM 104.9. If it's all about arses, Steve, why don't gays like a bit of tit?
I think there might be a lecture on that at the Royal Institute tonight. I'm not sure.
Yeah, Stephen Hawking.
Yeah, I think he's giving it.
Brilliant.
I'll tell you something else, though. That's about cavemen and that.
Yeah.
Right?
Not really. Go on.
Do you know,
I love the idea of a little gay fella. He's pulled a bird, he's just, all he's done is focused on the cleavage and he's gone, that's a lovely arse. Yeah. Right. He's got a bat, right, pulls the dress down, no! Where's the arse? I've been gone, there's boobs! Boobs!
I hate them!
They're my worst! No! Right, sorry, Carl.
Cavemen and that.
Yeah. Back to it. Doesn't drop a beat, does he?
Do you know, like, when you get a bit scared, and, you, and the hairs on your back and that sort of go up?
Well, I haven't got a particularly hairy back, but go on.
No, but on your neck or whatever.
Oh, yeah.
On your head.
Do you know...
not on your face, but... sure.
Do you know where that comes from? Do you know why that happens?
Why it happens?
Yeah.
To probably... to look more fierce.
Yeah.
Probably residue of, like, the erectile tissue with the, you know, would make you look apes and that would make you look slightly bigger, your outline bigger. Is that the answer?
Yeah, just cavemen in front of dinosaurs and that, they sort of went, oh. And then...
Well, it wasn't cavemen in front of dinosaurs, was it? Because cavemen weren't alive when dinosaurs were alive.
There was a couple knocking about.
Right, okay, fair enough.
There was a crossover point, surely.
Not dinosaurs like
15 million. Was the Ice Age, there were still big reptiles.
I think it's fairly common knowledge that the dinosaurs did not exist.
Well, who gave the dinosaurs the name?
Well, no. Well, no. He's using cavemen as any genus of Homo. I know he's thinking of the Flintstones,
yes.
But I'm giving him a bit of, I'm giving him like, an instep into evolution here. But,
I should just point out, you know cavemen didn't have cars which they motored by running along the street.
And they didn't mix cement in pelicans.
You're aware of that?
Right. Go on, Carl.
Shall we have the Rockbusters answers? Yeah, you've got to get that out of the way.
I'd love to. Number one was, don't be stealing my tools, take your sister's. The initials were NK. That was Nick Ursel. right?
Nick Ursel?
Nick Ursel. 80s.
I don't know. I've never heard of that band.
Nick Kershaw.
Nick Nick Kershaw. How does Nick Kershaw? Don't move on! Nick Ursel! What's Nick Ursel?
Jesus.
Alright. It doesn't count!
Let's just leave it behind us, alright?
Second one was, buy it if you want. You know, I'm not bothered. You can think about it. Come back, have a look around, think it over. I'm not fussed. The initials were SC. That was soft sell. Right?
That works.
Yeah.
Well done.
That works.
Right. And that's good. I can play 10-pin bowling again. That's O. That's outcast. Right?
What?
What does that mean? Outcast?
You're out, you broke your arm. Right? Got the cast.
Oh, that's ridiculous.
That's ludicrous.
I mean, that's ridiculous.
You broke your arm, you were in a cast, you got rid of the cast, you're outcast.
Did anyone get that?
Yeah.
I mean, I am stunned.
I think, to be fair, that was because how many bands begin with O?
Yeah.
I think that's why people got it.
Exactly. But there were guesses, yeah. I could probably make Oasis work if I tried hard enough.
Who's done that?
Oh, pardon me.
So, outcast.
That's ridiculous.
Why is it ridiculous?
But it's ridiculous.
Worse than that.
Well,
that's worse than that.
The leap to
bowling. We had worse than that!
No,
imagine that!
I remember when I did my wrist in, then it fixed, I went 10-pin bowling.
What did you do
so it's what you did. Brilliant. So, next week's quiz is what am I thinking? You're an idiot, Carl. Play a record.
Why did you do your wrist in?
Crash.
A crash. You had a crash?
Yeah.
That sounds like a story we've not explored.
Not much to it. I just went on a free, sort of rally day. got in this car. I'd been working all night, right, so I wasn't the best condition to be whizzing around the track in a car.
Sure.
Like a Formula One type car.
Yeah.
Spun out of control, hit some mud, smashed it all in, wrote it off, and I didn't realise I'd done a load of damage until...
Well, you landed on your head, but you were fine.
Yeah.
Who's the winner?
Mike Godlin. Bad time from the Jayhawks on XFM 104.9. Steve Merchant, Ricky Gervais, Carl.
We're having a good time.
We are indeed.
Alright. Yeah. Carl, what you got lined up for us now?
Right, well, you've got a choice.
Nelly dead?
You can have a bit of educating.
Yeah, let's have educating. Come on.
Educating, Ricky. Can we just clarify what this is? I think a lot of new listeners perhaps aren't familiar with this.
It's when Carl looks on the internet and finds a weird story about, you know, the double knob, fun. And tells me about it, and it's usually not true.
Okay.
If it is true, I know it already. Go on then, Carl.
They're not really weird stuff, it's just stuff that's gone on. That's interested me, that's all it's about, and I educate about it.
I should just confirm that we've had a number of emails that say the baby born without a knob and then having one transplanted from a baby that luckily enough had two knobs is apparently true.
Well, yeah, no, listen, listen. So, I don't question that you could be born with a deformity and get someone's, you know, fingers, knobs, what I'm saying is, it didn't happen with the doctor goes, I'll leave with it. I don't believe it. That baby's got two knobs.
Exactly.
What a coincidence. I bet that little bit of information isn't in there, is it?
Sure.
That he went out the door, I'm gonna get a coffee, came back, bloody hell, hold on, look, here's an extra knob, I found an extra knob. we put that knob on there. Perfect.
Right, well, you've gone, you've opted for the headline, It Nelly Died. Right?
Yeah.
It's about this elephant.
Yeah.
80 years old. In Africa. Right? It's had quite a good life and that. but then what happens is, I don't know what it's been eating, but, his teeth fall out.
Yeah, that's what most elephants die of that, because they grind them down, the teeth. Until they can't chew anymore, and they most elephants of old dying of old age with an elephant is the fact that you haven't got teeth anymore.
Hmm. Well, it's had a good innings. It was 80.
Yeah.
Right? So anyway,
they used to pop the food up and feed it to it, and it lived quite happily.
No, what they did was the village got together, said,
chewed the food for
that's sad, isn't it? Made it some
false teeth.
Made it some teeth out of wood. Wooden teeth for this elephant, that's 80. What do you think of that?
I don't know. I don't know if it's true, I don't know, I mean...
No, it is, forget that, you've been proved wrong once, it is true. What do you think about that?
Carl, it's like saying, yeah, me Auntie Nora saw a ghost, what do you think about that? There's no comment, I can't comment on it.
Would you have gone to the trouble, is what I'm saying?
To build an elephant
and It's 80.
Yeah.
With all the problems Africa's got and that, and they're messing about making teeth for an elephant.
What problems have Africa got?
Well, there's not enough food to go around, so if an elephant's dead, that's a bit more food left. Do you know what I mean? Why?
Yeah, but you're assuming this is in the middle of a village where there was famine and starvation. It might have been South Africa, Kenya. You don't know. It's not all Ethiopia.
If it was a busy city, people in the village wouldn't have time to be messing about with making teeth and that, would they? It was a little village. Little village.
Yeah.
And a local elephant.
The local elephant. Like a local post office. I'll meet you by the elephant.
No, to be fair, Rick, I think I saw Bob Geldof on TV saying, please, people, stop making elephants' teeth. They are eating all the food, we're sending it over there.
F the number, where's the teeth? I don't know, it's possible.
It's possible
that they've made this elephant some dentures. It is possible.
Wouldn't it have been easier to just
pulp it?
Exactly. I'd fresh it up, serve it some soup or whatever.
Yeah, I mean, if you're making its teeth, you know, it's really, so I wouldn't have thought it would work for very long, and I wouldn't have thought the elephant would understand that it was teeth, so I wouldn't have been able to thought that the villagers could do it. I mean, top veterinary surgeons could have done some of it, but I think they made it all goodwill, but I don't want to thought it worked, so they probably end up dying or pulping it like I suggested. But, you know, thanks very much, play a record.
No, but didn't you say something about wooden teeth? Someone, you know, had wooden teeth.
I don't know, I think that was possibly my grandparents.
They had wooden teeth?
Yeah. Well, I don't know if it was wooden, I think the palate was wood, and then the teeth were... as you would normally.
That's like from the 16th century, though, isn't
it? Well, it was the 1940s.
They used to hammer them in without anaesthetic.
Really?
Yeah. Just put into the wooden. Oh God.
That's a rubbish time, isn't it? To live.
And other people's teeth, obviously dead people's teeth. You could replace it. Just bang it in for a while.
Oh.
Oh God, unbelievable. Oh dear. Play a record, Carl.
If you've had your teeth, if you've had teeth hammered into your gums.
Placebo, English Summer Rain on XFM 104.9. Right, okay, you got the final educating Ricky, Carl?
Get a load of this court case.
Yeah.
What happened was, right,
allegedly.
Fella's in court for something that he shouldn't have done, right?
Yeah. You got all the detail then, didn't you? Fingertips.
And the jury says, he's guilty, right? And the judge went, well, he's not guilty, off you go then. Right? He misheard it. He couldn't do anything about it, because once the judge has sort of said, you're not guilty, off you go, you can go home. And the jury were like, what are you doing? He said he's guilty. And he was like...
What do you think of the Thorns album?
I'm quite a big fan, Rick. Yeah, I like that sort of alt-country sound, I think.
I know. I like a compilation you made me, that was really good. The Jayhawks, thanks for that, by the way.
There was the hanging one, wasn't there? There was the hanging one that happened.
Are you still there?
What bands have you been checking out recently? Any new things?
Just exploring all kinds of stuff. Obviously, you know, I like dipping back into the old stuff. I'll tell you what I've been appreciating a lot recently, Rick. Billy Bragg.
Oh, brilliant, yeah.
Great guy.
Isn't he playing
in March, yeah. You might want to try and
check out the hanging one when the fella was-
Sorry, mate, go on.
When the fella was hung.
Well hung?
He was hung, and
He was hung.
He was hung by a rope.
So, isn't that- No, no, I think it was- wasn't he, a Chinese emperor? And the Ming, wasn't he hung?
Yeah.
Sorry, he was hung.
Some fella who'd done something, they hung him.
It's not a word anymore, he was hung.
Well, don't be doing that again, because you said squoze wasn't a word, and then I've shown you a menu today that someone sent, and it said fresh orange.
Yeah.
Squoze.
Inadvertent commas, and next to it was the word colour, spout C-O-L-O-R. So, presumably either American menu, right, in which case, there's loads of American words that we don't use, or it's just a badly typed piece of work.
Anyway, there was a bloke that was hung.
He was hung and that, but he didn't die.
Hung on that, he was definitely a Chinese, I remember him now, yeah.
He didn't die, and they said, oh, just hang on a minute whilst we change the rope and that, and he stood there waiting, changed the rope. They, tried to, you know, do it again, and, didn't work.
It didn't work, right.
So, they got another rope, right? Didn't work. And then they had to let him go, because it's like a, there's a well-known saying or something from this thing,
Yeah.
What?
Have you seen, do you like, Oh My Car Is On by, Tim Burton's new single?
I don't know that I'm particularly
it's brilliant. Can we play a bit later?
Know.
Yeah, can we play it? Let's play a record now and we'll, talk more a bit later.
Yeah.
Hey, can you, Carl, would you shut up?
Oh My Car Is On. Tim Burgess. Brilliant. XFM 104.9. Right. Well, we're running out of time here.
Yeah.
We had Carl in a little film, but I think we've only got time for Monkey News, you know?
Yeah.
What are you thinking, Carl?
Yeah, if you want to do that.
Yeah, let's do Monkey News.
Alright.
Play the jingle.
Oh, chimpanzee that, Monkey News!
Right, there's this monkey, right?
Oh, yeah.
I think his name was number 6 or number 7 or something, right? In this lab, right?
Yeah.
And, anyway, it's in there. with, like, you know, the rabbits and little mice and stuff like that. And, The woman who works in the lab, what would you call her? The nurse?
Depends, what turns out her job was. If she was a lab assistant, you call her a lab assistant.
Right.
I mean, they probably call her by her name.
Alright, lab assistant, right?
Kirsty.
So she's-
I think it's probably Kirsty.
Right,
Kirsty Morris.
Well, she's in there, right?
Yeah.
And she doesn't work with many people and that. She's mainly on her own with, you know, just putting lipstick on rabbits and stuff like that, right?
Chimpanzee?
So,
chimpanzee, he's putting on lipstick, chimpanzee, so he's got hairy legs.
He gets pally, right, with this woman.
Yeah.
Because, you know, it gets to a point when she sees him every day.
The way he tries to string out like it's a narrative love story. The chimp put its hand out and grabbed her, and then you're thinking that he made a move on her.
So,
right, come on,
he's allowed out. He's allowed out.
It's not a story, is it?
He's allowed out the cage and what have you. Anyway, so he's wandering about, and as time goes on, he's watching what she's doing more and more.
Yeah.
Right. So he notices like the code on the door, right?
Right.
She, whatever, 247 or whatever.
Yeah.
He goes, right, I've clocked that, I've got
yeah.
that, I'll remember that, right?
Mm.
And then he goes, right, there's a
definitely
lot of lipstick not. And that knocking about, a lot of makeup.
Right, okay.
Let
no, no, there's
let
no way.
Finish.
No! Because,
so,
Steve, you know what's gonna happen. I know what's gonna happen.
So he's there.
It's ridiculous.
And he's going, well, if it's there, you know what I mean? So while she's messing about with the rabbit, he gets there, he's in front of the mirror, putting a little bit of lippy on. Right, right.
It's gone too far,
Steve. Right, your mic's off, Rick. He's finishing
right.
the story.
So,
turn mine off as well.
It's looking pretty good.
I didn't mention the mascara!
It's looking alright, right? So it knows the code on the door, 247, right? So when she's sort of messing about with the rabbit, right, he goes, right, right? So it knows the code on the door, 247, right? So when she's sort of messing about with the rabbit, right, he goes, right, here's my chance. He's looking good. 247, out the door. That's your man's there. He's like, all right, Kirsty. Right?
Don't talk shit!
I Feel Free from Queen, that's pretty much the last track, isn't it, guys? I imagine on XFM 104.9.
Well, I mean, I've got nothing to say after that. Ridiculous. Ridiculous story. I mean, that's worse than the bank robbery to me.
Yeah.
That he clocks at. And the bloke on the desk. All right, Kirsty. Oh, you're 2 foot shorter and hairy.
She yeah. wasn't a looker anyway.
She wasn't a looker anyway! Brilliant. Oh, play record and say to you, we'll see you next week for the last time for a little
while.
Oh, Everett. Oh, I'd love to end with Everett.
See you later. It's brilliant. Going out on a bang.
Fortune Faded by, Red Hot Chili Peppers on XFM 104.9. With Ricky Gervais, Stephen Merchant and Carl Pilkington for the last time.
Yes, we've said that before, of course. So don't get your hopes up.
Yeah.
Yeah, we've had some highs and some lows,
some laughs, some tears. Carl,
tears.
You're concentrating.
Lots
of tears,
mainly from the audiences.
Yeah. Now, before we get into that, before we get into talking about maybe some of the hijinks we've had, looking back, looking forward as well.
Yeah.
I came in, Carl was sitting at the desk, he went, alright. I went, alright, we're in, yeah. He went, see that Alan Clark Diaries? I went, no, I didn't. He went, no, no, I don't know. A lot of people talking about it. He went, I've never kept a diary. Keeping a diary will always get you into trouble. And I said, like Anne Frank. What did you say, Carl?
The woman in the cupboard?
That's what he said.
The woman in the cupboard.
And I went, save it. Save what? It.
You never speak to Carl off air. Save it all from when we're on the wires.
He went, but what does she do? What does she do except be in a cupboard? What does she have to write about? and I said, well, her thoughts. Do you know Anne Frank?
That's all I know about Anne is. There's no point pretending it.
Anne!
That I know stuff.
Yeah.
Right,
Well, tell us everything you know about Anne Frank.
She was in a cupboard.
Yeah, what else?
If she didn't do that, I wouldn't know about her, seriously. That's all I know about her.
Yeah.
So what did she do?
But what do you how do you think we know about her cupboard because of her book, don't we?
But hang on, what in the bigger scheme of things, why was she in a cupboard?
I don't know.
Right.
I honestly don't know.
You don't know anything else about Anne Frank beyond the fact that, to quote you, she was in a cupboard.
Well, what's she done then? You tell me, why should I know more about
firstly,
a woman in a
I
cupboard?
Don't think she was in a cupboard.
She wasn't in a cupboard. She was in an attic.
Alright.
Yeah.
So what was she doing?
She was hiding from the Nazis. She was hiding from the Nazis.
But isn't that the first place they'd look, sort of? work from the top down.
Oh, they weren't specifically looking for Anne Frank.
They weren't going, where is she?
Where's Frank?
If she gets that book out, we are in a deep shit. We've got to stop the book. They were just looking generally. She what? Was, I think she was, she was 13, 14, she was
yes.
hiding, she was Jewish and she was hiding, lived in Amsterdam, didn't she?
Yeah, as much of her family were having to hide, being yeah. helped by, you know, friends, yeah. non-Jewish.
In a cupboard, cupboards, you know.
And how long, you know, how long did she sort of hide up there for?
Until she was caught.
Long enough to write a book.
So she even got caught after all that?
What do you mean, so she even got caught? We're talking about one of the great, you know, humanist tragedies of our times. And you're going, she couldn't even stay hidden.
What do you mean, did she get caught?
No, I'm just saying, like, you know, it's not a great tip then, is it? Do you know what I mean? She didn't do it well. She didn't hide until I escaped it. She
her diaries
caught.
Are not a manual on how to hide from people. It's not how to win
well,
at
I don't know anything about her. And we might be going down some ground that's a bit dodgy. I don't know enough about it. Maybe it's best just leaving it. All I was saying is yeah. diaries, you know, what do you do them for? Have you kept one, Steve?
Never kept a diary, no.
Right.
I can understand your fear that it might get discovered, someone might read it, find out all about your inner secrets. Of course, the good thing about you is you tell everyone what you think about them.
Yeah.
Yeah, but...
No one's gonna find a diary and go, oh god.
Can't believe it, Carl doesn't like my haircut.
Yeah, yeah. Carl thinks I look like Dave Hill from Slade. Yeah, I told you that, didn't I? Yeah, I told you that.
Do you think they'll last though, diaries and that? No, because they were a bit of a time killer, weren't they? It was something to do at the end of the day, whereas now these iPods and that.
It's fantastic! The iPod,
I mean?
The iPod of Anne Frank.
Yeah.
No,
the
I mean.
New from Sony. That would yeah. be great, wouldn't it? Hall of Greatest Hits. Who could forget? Oh.
Well,
dear.
I didn't believe that then. I didn't know it was that deep. I thought it was just like a, you know.
You thought it was like, didn't you?
Adrian Mole type thing.
Thorns from my favourite album of last year, that. And I can't remember. We'll be doing a bit of that, playing some of our favourite songs. We've got a couple of requests.
Oh,
in
really?
Fact, yeah, got a one of the celebrity requests, Matt Lucas from Little Britain, is listening in.
Oh, yeah.
So is it your last show? I said, yeah. And I said, do you want me to play a record? And he said, what's your favourite group? Guess Matt Lucas's favourite group. Now remember, him and David are the new darlings of comedy.
Yeah.
They're cool, they're trendy, everyone loves Little Britain. They're comedy geniuses, they're only gonna get bigger. What's his favourite group of all time?
That is tricky. Level 42.
New. Carl, have a guess.
Well, there's gonna be something weird, innit, if you're saying this.
Well.
So. How old's the band?
They're probably about as old as him.
How old is he?
Oh, Carl, have a guess.
ABBA.
No, it's, why'd you say ABBA?
They're good, aren't they?
No, it's the Proclaimers.
The Proclaimers?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. And I know he's listening, but, you know.
I mean, there's nothing wrong with the Proclaimers, I just can't imagine anyone getting that excited about them.
I bet that's why he likes you, because you hang out with him, don't you?
I do hang out with him.
He thinks he's like the closest thing. He knows one of the Proclaimers.
Wait till he meets my twin brother.
Yeah, he's gonna have a field day, isn't he? Yeah. So I was honest. I said I can't play the Proclaimers, but we're playing another.
Where did they come? Because I don't really remember the Proclaimers particularly from when I was young.
Well, let me give you a little blast. I gave a little. But in two-part harmony.
Of course.
That was the
but
main thing.
They were
thing.
Very popular for a while, weren't they?
I think they had sort of three big hits in sort of about 1981, was it?
Yeah. Oh, I forget.
Yeah, 80s.
Scottish. They did sing in Scottish accents, which I thought was quite refreshing. They didn't do the fake American thing.
No, that was good. Yeah.
But again, I just can't imagine sort of being in that. When would I be in the mood to put on a Proclaimers record?
When you've run out of Crankies stuff, I suppose.
I guess so, yeah.
If you've played all your Crankies records,
and the Muppets album.
Yeah. Pop on the Proclaimers. Now, we were talking before the break about Anne Frank in her cupboard.
Yes.
Now,
I'm still a little bit concerned that Carl's not quite got his head around Anne Frank's diary. Yeah. It's not like a children's book. It's not like The Lion, Anne Frank and the Wardrobe.
No.
She's not doesn't go into a fantasy land when she goes into the attic.
I'm just glad that old Mother Hubbard didn't help the Nazis.
Sure.
Because that's the first place she'd look.
Yeah.
Isn't it? The Nazis go, we've got old Mother, but she thinks she knows where she is.
Yeah.
She'd have gone straight there.
I think with Hubbard, it's like, if I just briefly mention Hubbard. now Hubbard goes to the cupboard to get, I can't remember exactly.
Her poor dog a bone.
She goes to get the dog a bone.
But when she got there,
the cupboard was bare.
The poor dog had
none. Is there more to that than I, because that's all I remember. Is there further verses? Does she finally get a bone? Does she go on an adventure?
Oh, what, you mean the second verse is, then she looked in the fridge and realised that's where she kept the bone, and so the dog was laughing.
Exactly.
No, there isn't another verse.
That's all of it.
I think so. Although they went to the cupboard to get a bottle of bone. When she got there, the cupboard was bare, and so the poor dog had none. No, I think that's the end of it. I think it's a moral.
I think it's a moral that. What's the moral?
Well, if you got a dog, keep some bones in the cupboard.
Right. Because I always, even as a kid, I remember thinking that it's quite a tragic sort of picture they paint. I imagine maybe she's
it's
lost.
Short,
her-
isn't it?
It's short,
isn't it? It's that's amazing.
But I always wondered whether perhaps she's had a nervous breakdown. Maybe her husband's died recently. She's just not got any food.
She doesn't really know what's going on.
The dog's yapping away. Eventually, she kind of wakes out of this kind of depressed stupor. She goes to the cupboard. There's nothing there. It's just a really depressing, morbid. Sort of tell. I don't know if maybe it's originated from something in history. I know that Jack and Jill went up the hill and they fell down again.
That's a story about illicit lovers.
That's apparently based on that. Obviously, Ring a Ring of Roses.
It dates
back to plague times. So I don't know about Hubbard. Humpty Dumpty. Not so sure about this. This is something I remember as a kid thinking, at what point was it decided that Humpty Dumpty was a giant Eggman?
I don't know.
Because there's nothing in the actual rhyme. There's no actually, it's not Humpty Dumpty,
it's not,
the Eggman's at all.
I don't know. My concern is more if, I mean, his parents were a little bit cruel, because if you are
called
the
Dumpties
of, say, Surrey, don't call your firstborn Humpty.
Yeah.
Because straight away, it's going to be embarrassing for him at school, isn't it?
Yeah.
I don't know what it, I'm just saying, well, I'm trying to go all the things on the is that it as well?
That's all of it.
Oh,
and
God.
Also, I don't mean to be pedantic, because I know it's a children's
is it like an Edward Lear thing, or that's before that, is it?
But I don't mean to be pedantic again, but if you've got a giant Eggman and he's fallen into bits, you know, all the king's men, fine, they're there, they can piece that together again. Don't send horses in.
No, because
that's just a whole eggy, horsey mess.
Not dexterous enough. They're going to make it worse.
They're just going to be standing on it.
They are going to make it worse.
It's not great.
Just standing on it. Get the horse out of the way. No, he's definitely there.
But again, maybe I'm sure some of the, you know, the mental people.
Is it pre-Lewis Carroll or? If it's Lewis Carroll, it just came with the illustration.
I guess
but
so.
He gave it to someone to illustrate. He goes, illustrate Humpty Dumpty. He goes, we've made him an egg.
Yeah, a sort of egg with eyes and a face.
Yeah.
I mean, I suppose because the moral of that is if you're fragile,
if you're
an enormous egg,
Mr. Dumpty, get down from the wall. I'll be fine.
Yeah.
Because I'll tell you what, there'd be
that's
no medical.
Way to happen.
Yeah.
Frankly,
I don't know, Carl. What was your favourite nursery rhyme when you were growing up?
Didn't really do that much reading as a kid.
Are you joking?
You surprised me.
You're joking.
Ones. What's the one with, loads of people in a bed? What's that one?
Oh, there was one in the bed and the little one said roll over. Yeah.
No, because that's not really even got a story to it, is it? That's
but
just-
hold on though, I'll stop you there. It doesn't even say people. It says there was 10 in the bed and the little one, little what? They could be anything. I don't know what they are. Roll over, and they all rolled over and one fell out. There was 9 in the bed and the little one said, roll over.
Now where is the little one in the bed?
I don't know, but worse than that, what has he got over the other 9?
That he can demand they roll out the bed.
And why is no one getting back in?
Yeah, they're just lying on the floor.
We're here now.
Yeah.
I don't know.
How does that end as well? Where's that going?
It goes on, there was one in the bed, and the little one said, again, he just says, presumably he's telling himself roll over, there was one in the bed and there was a roll over. So he rolled over, and one fell out, that's him.
That's him.
There was none in the bed, and the little one said, roll over. So now he's calling the shots, presumably laying on the pile
there.
Of others.
They're just still rolling around.
I don't know. I don't know, Carl. We've got to look into this. If anyone knows why Dumpty was an egg, if Hubbard eventually found a dog a bone, and what was the little one doing? What was the little, what did the little one think he was doing, for God's sake?
When I saw my dad last year, he was telling me about one, about a fella who's got some clothes you can see through. What's that one?
You don't mean the Emperor's new clothes?
Yeah, what's that one about?
Well, that's a genuinely good little parable, that.
Yeah, because it's now used for, people who are scared to sort of slag something off because it's sort of like really cool and they don't want to be the one that shouts it, and then one person goes, hold on,
very briefly, the king wants some new clothes, right, he's the king, he goes, who's gonna make me some new clothes, various people come to me, says, I don't like that, it's not interesting enough. One guy, who's just a bit of a con artist, he comes along, he goes, I've made you this magic suit, look, and it's nothing. He goes, invisible. Put it on, the king puts on nothing, because there is nothing, but thinks there's something, because, you know, he wants to buy into it and everything.
And he goes, it's the finest stitching, he goes, look at it, can you see it? No, only a genius can see how good this suit is. And the king goes, yeah, it's brilliant, yeah. It's great. And he goes out, and just, is it a woman or a little kid?
Well, everyone's applauding, they're going, you look great, even though his tackle's hanging out, he's, you know, he's nothing.
Even though he's got a king-size, sort of like, bit of meat and two veg, wobbling, dragging down the street.
Exactly. And then one little boy goes, he's not wearing anything!
The king is in the altogether, Know that one?
So, well, did anyone else buy one? Or was-
Okay, play a record.
Play a record, Carl.
Play a record.
Carl, just play a song.
Jesus. Travis? Writing to reach you on XFM 104.9, alright?
Couple of emails here, try and respond to our, requests for, nursery rhyme related information.
Oh, go on.
Nikki Williams says that she was at infant school and she had a nursery rhyme book, and the book, in the book, and this may, again, may just be the illustrations, but apparently the 10 in the bed in there were small baby monkeys. Which you'll be loving, Carl. But, again, I suspect that might just be the illustrations.
I remember I had a book of nursery rhymes when I was little, and, my brother, it was, older than me, I was about 5, so he was about 16, and I remember him and his mate just absolutely cracking up, because it said, up Jack got and home did trot as fast as he could caper, he went to bed and bandaged his knob, N-O-B, with vinegar and brown paper. I've since found out that knob is like the old English for head, but I didn't know why they were laughing.
Of course.
They were just cracking up. This was, whenever one of my mate's brothers came around, he said, where's your nursery rhyme book? And he'd read it to him. Yeah. And it was just the funniest thing in the world.
The brown paper and vinegar was a popular method, because didn't Jack and Jill use that? They used something similar.
No, that was Jack and Jill.
That was Jack and Jill.
Yeah, that's Jack when he broke his crown, which obviously, oh, that means his head as well, doesn't it?
Yeah.
So he's fractured his skull, on a sort of like an outcrop of rock.
Yeah.
And then,
is that still used, the brown paper and vinegar?
I don't think it is.
I don't know, maybe Manchester they're still using that, I'm not sure.
Yeah.
Tracy and John Burton say that they, reckon Humpty Dumpty was actually a cannon that used to sit on the walls of the castle, in Colchester where they live.
That makes sense.
Yeah. That would make
a lot
of
sense.
Sat on
a wall. Great for all the things, I couldn't put them together again. So, they broke the cannon, or it meant it exploded.
Maybe the cannon fell apart.
Because people used to get blown up by cannons, just doing it wrong, didn't they?
Sure.
Which is hoist by your own petard.
Right.
Where that comes from.
Right, coming
back and blowing up in your face.
So that makes slightly more sense, because you would want to send for the king's men then.
Yeah, and the horses.
I think the horses just came along anyway.
Well, that was quicker.
Sure.
The quick king's men, it took them about 3 minutes, with the horses there in about a minute. but I mean, if it blew up, there's nothing I could do.
Yeah.
So we got to the bottom of that. See, the educational, Carl. See, this is real education.
Mm.
You know what I mean?
It's got a bit heavy though, doesn't it?
What, Humpty Dumpty? Yeah, it has got a little bit heavy. Let's dumb it down a little bit. What do you want to do? Mary, Mary, quite contrary?
We're doing Rockbusters in a bit.
Hang on a minute.
What?
Before you even get to Rockbusters. Oh, man alive, there are loads more verses to Old Mother Hubbard.
Are there?
I'm gonna digest these while we play the ads, and I'll see if there's any salient information I can give you afterwards.
Brilliant! Delays. Long time coming on XFM 104.9. With Ricky Gervais, Stephen Merchant and Carl Pilkington for the last time.
XFM 104.9.
Sad.
We've established that Hubbard went to the cupboard, Rick.
Yeah.
Get the dog a bone, the cupboard was empty.
Yeah.
As we all know. And
the dog didn't have any. End of story, so the dog didn't have any.
Well, no.
Hold on, go on.
It turns out there's what appears to be something like 15 other verses.
Not really.
Unbelievable. I'm not gonna go through all of them, Rick.
Right, any information?
I can tell you straight away that the dog, initially had none.
Yeah.
She went to the baker's to buy him some bread. When she came back, the poor dog was dead. Right, you're pretty upset about that.
Yeah.
She went to the joiners to buy him a coffin. When she came back, the poor dog was laughing. I don't know what he's up to.
Right.
She took a clean dish to get him some tripe, but when he came back, when she came back, he was smoking a pipe. I mean...
Okay, so the dog was winding her up then at the beginning, being dead.
I mean, he's pushing his luck, but especially if she's already depressed.
But do you know, if I was that dog, right, and I live with old Mother Hubbard, right, all that faffing around, I'd be going, I know there's no bones in the cupboard, right? What do you mean you're going to get me some bread? I'm a dog.
Yeah.
I'm not interested in bread. Get me some hamburgers.
Yeah.
So, I think I'd start winding her up.
She went to the Our House to get him some beer. When she came back, the dog sat in a chair.
See, I just said the dog had turned queer.
Yeah.
Make it rhyme at least, and also get a little, you know, he's smoking a pipe, he's having a laugh.
I'm beginning to wonder
he's bent. He's bent.
I'm beginning to wonder if this is based on fact, though, in any way, because she went to the grocer's to buy him some fruit. When she came back, he was playing the flute.
He's gay.
No, it is the flute, it's not, now this, I didn't even know there was a goat involved.
She went no.
She went to the tailor's to buy him a coat. When she came back, he was riding the goat.
Yeah, there you go. Dirty little, oh, what?
She went to the hatter's to buy him a hat. When she came back, he was feeding the cat. I mean-
I can't believe it. So I'm thinking the pipe's a crack pipe.
Hang on a minute. I think the gay thing's beginning to stand up.
Go on.
She went to the barber's to buy him a wig. When she came back-
He was having a frig?
He was dancing a jig. He's dancing a jig. You're dancing a jig.
Oh, he's dancing a jig, smoking a pipe, shagging a goat.
This is a bit of left field one though. She went to the cobbler's to buy him some shoes.
Why does he need shoes? I bet they're high heels.
Wait a second though. She went to the cobbler's to buy him some shoes. When she came back, you're never gonna believe this.
What?
He was reading the news.
Brilliant!
She went to the seamstress to buy him some linen. Again, don't know why. When she came back, the dog was a spinning.
Yeah.
She went to the hosiers to buy him some hose. When she came back, he was dressed in his clothes.
Yeah! Why did she want to
But this is the big payoff that we've been building to.
Right.
The dame made a curtsy, the dog made a bow, the dame said, your servant, the dog said, bow wow.
Right.
I mean-
Okay. I'm gonna probably do a few more verses during the next song.
During the course of the show?
Yeah.
Listen, before we move on, I should just say that we've had various people saying what was in the bed and what was the final line of the bed thing.
Why do they care?
It's extraordinary, isn't it? We've talked about politics in the past, great music, we play great songs.
Yeah, we've got Monkey News coming up talking about politics.
But Danny's said that apparently it ends with one in the bed, little one said good night.
Because he was all happy, he had the bed to himself, and there's nine of his mates piled on the floor.
Rick, but Ava counters that by saying, actually, one of the bed little ones said, come back, because he felt lonely. So-
We're never going to get to
know. I don't know, Rick.
This is the same as the Kennedy thing.
there's loads
of different opinions.
Conspiracy theories.
I know, we don't know what's going on. But Jimmy Webb, we go on, Jimmy Webb, Galveston, fantastic version, on XFM, 104.9. You know what, Steve? I know people are going to miss the talk about little Chinese fellas, little gay fellas, little monkey fellas, and all that.
Yeah.
But I think they're going to miss some great tunes as well.
I'd hope so.
She went to the jeweler's to buy him a clock, but when she got back...
What was he sucking?
A chalk ice.
A chalk ice, fine.
So...
Fine, respectable.
Yeah.
I sort of feel like, you know, one thing we've never done, Rick, is we've never pandered to people, but as it's the last show, we've got to give the audience what they want.
Right, what's this?
Well, yeah, and I was going to say things they don't want as well.
And,
you know, and, well, just basically to keep a smile on Carl's face.
Yeah.
I say a smile, a sort of not quite a scowl.
Yeah, he never really smiles.
So, yeah, it's just really as a chance for him to have a go. It's like, you know, you indulge an annoying child.
The only time Carl laughs is for no apparent reason.
Yeah.
What do you think, like?
What do you mean?
Well, sometimes you'll go, and I know you'll be thinking of what a monkey could do.
Yeah, it's like people who've had electroshock therapy.
Yeah! Oh, it's tied down biting on
exactly,
something.
Yeah.
Biting on a big leather pad.
Let me just tell you briefly what the prizes are. It's
that
the number-
That looks like a piece of shit.
Well, let me tell you. There's a number of mediocre CDs and DVDs.
That is real tight.
But mainly, what about this? It's the Lord of the Rings Collector's Edition.
Oh.
Well, the movies, you're thinking. No, it's the Radio 4 adaptation. It's only 14 hours long, Rick.
Oh, that is- throw that away. So, pop that in the bin. Either pop it in the bin or send it to some poor bastard who wins this quiz.
Exactly. If you're willing to take part in the quiz, you deserve 14 hours you'd be like wasted with that Tolkien tripe. So
right,
yeah. What are the clues then, Carl?
Right, as always, just you know, cryptic clues. No. That initials of a band or an artist. Yeah. Work it out. Yeah. Win the stuff.
Yeah. Email only.
Yeah, ricky.gervais@xfm.co.uk. First clue is as follows. The Jamaican fella wrote a review for
Good Taste. Good old Jamaican
he's
fella.
Back.
The Jamaican fella.
It's the last show the little Jamaican fella's made an appearance.
This normally suggests that you need to think of the answer in a Jamaican accent.
Yeah. Or not.
Yeah, or not.
Yeah, any accent. Or an accent. Or pronounce the word slightly differently.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, go on.
The Jamaican fella wrote a review for Phoenix Nights. Alright.
Yeah.
DC is on the initials.
DC? D for Derek?
Yeah, okay. DC, the Jamaican fella wrote a review for Phoenix Nights, that's the first one. Second one, three of them, second one is, we should all vote for Paul Daniels, David Blaine, Copperfield, The Great Soprendo, Tommy Cooper, and Darren Brown. We should all vote for them. Why is that? What was-
I've just got the first one.
E-S.
E-S.
Right? E-S.
Okay.
And the last one, Steve, what did your dad do? Huh?
Steve, what did my dad do?
What did your dad do?
Is that the question or are you asking me?
Well, Ricky, what did your dad do? It can work on anyone. What did your dad do?
Alright.
Right? That's E. Right?
What did your dad do?
Quickly, again, the Jamaican fella wrote a review for Phoenix Nights. Right? DC. Second one, we should all vote for Paul Daniels, David Blaine, Copperfield, Great Soprano. No, but that's important. Right? ES, and the last one, you know, Steve, what did your dad do? Right?
Okay.
The initial E.
Ricky.gervais@xfm.co.uk. We don't want to speak to you, please don't phone up.
Remember, you could win some Lord of the Rings tripe.
Right. No more on XFM.
Right. Last
Rockbusters everything. Faith No More and their version of I'm Easy on XFM 104.9 with Gervais, Steve Merchant, Carl Pilkington. Rick, we-
For the last time.
We've only really got three topics of discussion on this show. I think you agree with that.
Little Chinese fellas.
Little Chinese fellas.
Monkeys.
Monkeys.
And the gays.
The gay people.
Yeah.
We're hoping to cover all those subjects today. Monkey News is coming later. I'm sure we can find something to discuss about gay people.
We've done a few gays.
I suppose we've talked about the dog thing.
Yeah. Big time.
I think you'll be enjoyed with this. This is something that's got sent through to us. I'm not quite sure who by, but thanks very much for it. It's a story that was in the press recently. I'm not going to give you the headline. I think it gives away too much. I think, Carl, you'll be particularly interested in it. A farmer in eastern China, basically, he paid £1,300, or the Chinese equivalent, to marry a woman, and, basically she refused to sleep with him after the wedding, complaining that she felt unwell. 6 days after the ceremony, she tried to run away, but the farmer followed her. He found her in some neighbouring town. They grappled together. The bogus bride's false breasts fell off.
It is hard after his old tricks,
It wasn't as hard.
Trying to do another show in Chinese this time.
But it was a man.
Oh,
and,
no.
Apparently, it was an arranged marriage. I don't know who sorted that out.
Did he get his money back?
I think
men are cheaper than women, to marry in China, I think.
But, you've got to be pretty simple not to realise that the person you're marrying's a bloke, surely.
Well, no, if he didn't have a little look, what was in the back of the store, he just saw the shop window, sort of lovely little Chinese lady there.
Yeah.
Right? You know.
The lovely hair, real breasts.
There's lumps where the breasts should be.
Yeah.
I can only assume they are breasts.
Yeah.
Right? You see him walking around going, what are they, breasts, or are they, you know, stealing sort of grapefruits? No, probably,
wouldn't there be quite a sort of long initiation period when they first get introduced and so on?
Not if he put his money down, he came and they said, well, I want a bird quickly, here's a grand.
Sure.
Get me one. They're not gonna say, do you want real breasts or They're just gonna assume.
Sure.
Yeah, he's one.
Yeah, yeah,
little Chinese lady.
But who is he paying? Where is he buying this woman from?
For the Chinese lady shop.
Chinese lady shop.
Yeah.
Sure.
So,
yeah.
Is one in China, I think.
Okay.
So,
yeah.
Not really a town.
Not exactly a town, more a novelty street.
And the roads are very slippery.
Very sticky.
I tell you what, though.
What?
I was looking at their menus when I was walking out, and they don't waste anything, do they?
Why?
Duck's tongue on the menu.
Yeah, but it's better when you say it. Alright, duck's tongue. A duck's tongue, really?
You sure that wasn't the proprietor?
Coldplay, warning sign on XFM, 104.9. Carl, look at that. What is it? What is it?
An apple.
Right, right, okay. What am I doing to it?
You're messing with it.
Yeah, and what's happening to it?
It's gone off a bit.
Yeah! Would you kiss it for 100 quid?
No.
How's it going? Would you just like just kiss
no,
it?
No, I wouldn't.
Why? 100 quid?
What are we doing this for?
I think I read this same feature on Woken, I'm not sure. Seriously, Carl, I'm intrigued to know how much would you have to pay
kiss
to kiss Ricky's nipple?
Not suck it or lick it or anything like that. Just, like that, just on the nipple.
£5 grand.
£5 grand to kiss my nipple? Well, if you do it for five, you do it for one. £1,000 cash to kiss my nipple.
No, I'm not doing it.
You're joking. £1,000 to kiss my nipple. Come on, it's the last show.
No, I'm not doing it.
2,000.
If you had the money there and, like, if you had it there now, I might do it.
For what?
I'm not doing it.
500 quid?
No. Stop taking it down.
What's happening to-
£2 grand.
£2 grand? So you've gone down from 5 to 2 straight away. Look, look.
Steve, what's going on?
I seriously think I'd like to see you kiss his nipple
well,
for
I'm not,
2 seconds.
It's not gonna happen, is it? So.
If Steve wants it and I want it, that's 2 to 1.
It's not gonna happen.
I thought it was a democracy, this show.
You're not educating Ricky or what?
Email in if you'd like to see, or rather hear, Carl kiss Ricky's nipple for 2,000 pounds.
This is not gonna happen.
Come on, Carl.
Right.
It's not like he's Jono's nipple.
Next.
Next. Okay, okay.
Would you kiss this for
right, okay, wrong. But now what are you doing? What are you doing educating Ricky?
Do you want to set that
up? Why were you looking, by the way? Why were you looking at that? You didn't have to look at that.
What are you doing?
Go on.
Right, this is when I teach Ricky stuff. Just give him some headlines to sort of tease him into what's gone on this week that you might want to know about.
Yeah, go on.
Is that important?
Yeah.
Right,
okay,
you got that?
Yeah.
That'd be something to do with ants. So,
where there's a will, there's a way.
Right, okay, that'd be something about sucking mints.
Hook, line, and good thinkers.
God. Okay.
Right, so which of those are you choosing?
I'll have the, is that important?
What, you want to do it now? I was just
gonna
leave
it. Yeah, go on, let's do one now, yeah, come on.
All
it's
right.
Christmas Eve, open one, come on.
You know I don't like anteaters.
Why?
Okay, so I should just point out to people that as far as Carl is convinced, the stories that he's about to relate are absolutely 100% true.
Yeah.
You be the judge of whether
he's seen them on the internet, of course they're true, go on.
Anteaters, yeah.
Why don't you like them?
I've told you before, I just don't, sort of. It annoys me that an animal's named after what it eats. You don't need
it. Yeah, but it didn't choose it, did it?
Yeah, but if there's nothing else that it can be called, it's like, oh, what's it do? I don't know. What's it eating? It's eating ants, right, let's call it an anteater.
What,
it's not good enough.
But why are you annoyed at it, though, for someone else calling it being lazy?
Because it obviously doesn't do anything else. Do you know what I mean?
But what do you want to call the chartered surveyor?
Well, whatever, just a proper name.
What's the proper name?
Well, I'm just saying.
But tell me an animal that's a proper name to you.
A beaver. That's pretty good.
Why is that a proper name?
It doesn't matter anyway, I don't understand what they're about.
Right, you and anteaters have got issues.
Okay, sometimes I genuinely don't understand what his thought processes are. Go on, right, okay, you don't like anteaters because they just eat ants and that's what they're named after, go on.
do you know that an anteater can, stick its tongue in and out 160 times in a minute?
No, didn't know that.
Right.
Okay.
Okay. Oh, it's rubbish.
Thanks.
No, but do you think that's good?
Because I don't know
what that is. What do you mean? Shall I call Norris McWhirter? What do you mean, do I think that's good? What, compared to what?
You see, I read it and thought, so what? So it's interesting.
Well, we think so what as well.
So you still put it down as something interesting to tell me?
No, but it's the fact that that is meant to be amazing,
I did 148 last night in a minute, right?
Great record! Oh, well, hold on. There's my nipple. How many could you do if you if it meant you had to touch my nipple at the end? £2,000. Ben, Baby Bear, on XFM 104.9. We do talk twaddle.
Oh, gosh.
I mean, I don't know why we haven't got complaints. We haven't got any complaints, have we?
No listeners.
We've had one.
No one listening.
No, it must be that, because Kilroy, he's probably got a big show, and it's all over the place. Yeah. Poor, you know, it's, mind you, you know, I'd be annoyed if he'd have said that about me.
Yeah.
But he's got to be careful who he annoys, because he will end up having to move him with Salman Rushdie. Do you know what I mean?
Is Salman, is he still on the run?
No. No, he's out. I've seen him twice. I think he's out all the time now. I bet his flat's a pigsty.
Sure.
It was not neat when he was living with 400 CIA people
You remember he went into hiding, I think it was mid-80s, I can't remember exactly.
Yeah, that's right.
He went into hiding, he was in there, he was hiding, basically, surrounded by security guards, confined to his flat for about 10 years or something.
I'd have thought so, yeah.
Have you ever seen a picture of his missus?
Yeah, are you annoyed?
Well, I mean, man alive, she's like, I think she's like a former Miss India or something, stunning.
Yeah.
Have you seen a picture of him? I mean, he might be a great man and a talented writer and an intellectual fella, but, Jesus. Do something with the beard.
Yeah, but he's busy, isn't he?
What?
He's busy writing
stuff. How did he pull her? When he was just basically in there? In his flat?
I don't know. Internet?
Possibly.
Just got to know him, and then she kept saying, send a picture. He goes, no, no, I'm not sending a picture, come round.
Yeah. Read some of the books, they're brilliant.
They're brilliant. She goes, well, yeah, now I'm in love with you. Let's have a look. All right, well, I'm in love with you now, so. Yeah.
You know, he's going, got me own place.
Got me own place, yeah. I got a few staff.
Yeah,
there's a few other people hanging around. Don't worry about it.
I mean a lot.
I'll tell you something else that'll annoy you.
Yeah.
Stephen Hawking, not only married, but dumped her for his, nurse.
Extraordinary, isn't it?
So he's pulling birds left, right and centre.
Well, you know, it's true that I mean, not so much now, but years ago I was not the ladies' man.
But you are now. Really. You weren't sort of suave and sophisticated. You weren't,
exactly.
You weren't the James Bond type that you've,
I wasn't the James Bond of TV comedy.
I remember, Carl, when he, you first met him about 3 years ago, what did you think?
Just a bit odd.
I love it!
And that's coming from him.
I know. Yeah.
But I'll tell you what, it used to really annoy me, talking of, do you remember there was that story, I think it was a world record-breaking attempt, there was a bloke, I think it was up in a car park, in a pub car park, in sort of Leeds or something.
No, Mansfield. It was a car park in Mansfield, and he broke the record for being buried alive.
Being buried alive.
I mean, and he was literally in a casket. Like, in, not David Blaine out in the lovely sunshine with loads of Jonathan Ross waving to you.
Yeah.
No, none of that. Paul McCartney calling you. Yeah. You know what I mean? He was buried alive in the dark with just a tube.
Yeah.
For communication.
I think he was buried about, he's buried about 10 feet underground. There's a tube which they, people would communicate and send
and
stuff
put water down and
I remember reading the story. I was interested in it. I remember reading it and there was one element of the story.
You would think it was a cheap holiday.
Well,
you know, you're not going to pay those prices. 400 quid, whole seasons, you're having a laugh. That's nothing. Mansfield car park.
And, there was another one. It said in the news report, it said that while he was down in the ground, he began and ended a relationship with a woman. While he was down there, some fan who was a fan of what he was doing, he started communicating with her through the tube. I don't know the ins and outs of it, but they began a relationship and it ended. And I have to say, I remember thinking, you know, when you read that there's a man.
How did it end?
Well,
why
did
you go that this isn't working? That's twice you stood me up.
Yeah.
Well, I can't get out, can I?
But I remember thinking at the time, you know, I was to say, I was not the sort of the ladies' man that I am now. I remember at the time reading it and thinking, there's a bloke, you know, he's pulling women 10 feet underground through a tube.
Through a tube. I'm out and about with some of the most expensive hair products on the market.
I've got to sit down and ask myself some very serious questions.
Oh dear.
Extraordinary. I don't know if he did the world record attempt. I don't know if he broke it. I don't know how that happened, but good luck to him.
What do you mean a hole though? Like what? A proper thing or is he moving about? How big is
it? No, it was just that I think it was just buried alive in a casket. I don't know, just down there, probably lying on his back maybe, just waiting for little bits of water.
But could he get out if he wanted to?
Well yeah, he could say, can you get me out? He couldn't just leave and then come back. There was people-
So someone's there then?
No, they buried him and said, well, we better go back in a couple of weeks, see how he's doing. What do you mean someone's there? Of course there's someone there. Norris McWhirter for one, I'd imagine, going, 3 days, just a few more to go.
And what, why
is it Norris or who's alive, Ross or Norris?
I think it's Norris.
Right,
you're looking up here.
What's that? It annoys me a bit, all this sort of, you know, getting in a hole and in a box and all that, and people going, oh, that's good. I mean, if he was doing something when he was down there, making something or whatever, you'd go, that's quite clever, but I don't understand all the fuss about, I don't know, people are just making a fuss about things that aren't that clever these days. It's just, you know what I mean?
I don't reckon he beat Anne Frank's record.
No, I think she's got the record.
I know, yeah, and she did something, she wrote a book. So, you must think that she's pretty good then.
Yeah, but at least she did something.
Yeah, I know, yeah. That's what I'm saying.
That's what I mean. There's some fuss, about a woman who's going up Everest on a bike, right? Someone's walked it. That's harder than going on a bike.
No, it's not.
Of course it is.
Of course it's not.
Of course it is.
Not walking uphill. Better than
riding about on a bike's better than walking everywhere.
Even not uphill.
Well.
No? Don't agree with me. Why do people get off their bike and walk it up a hill?
They don't always. I see people.
No, but why do they? When people are going up a hill on a bike, but they get off and push the bike.
Just saying.
No, what why is that?
It doesn't matter.
Because it's, do you think it's because it's harder? They go, I'll tell you what, this should be a lot easier on the bike, but I'll tell you what, I'm on a bit of a challenge. I'll get off and walk up this hill. You dopey.
Go along then, clap for her and that. You know what I mean? When someone's doing a London Marathon in a car, you can go and clap them, because that's just the same as far as I'm concerned. It's not hard.
Play record.
Imbecile.
So Alive, Ryan Adams on XFM, 104.9, Ricky Gervais, Steve Merchant, Carl Pilkington. For the last time.
Well, you might do some other stuff later.
Oh yeah, I mean, yeah, for a little while at least.
Well, we won't be around for, yeah, foreseeable future. Better things to do, bigger fish to fry.
Well, you've got your music show that you'll do, which will be good.
Yeah. Yeah. The other radio stations are more interesting.
Just, I think we've just got enough energy left for the last 35 minutes.
Yeah.
We've given them a lot, Steve.
We've given them a lot.
We've come in here, week in, week out, every Saturday. Never late.
We've always given them, you know, 30%. Really poor. That we go, oh, 30% yeah, of energy.
Yeah. Now, how did that start? People going, you've got to give 110%.
Yeah.
It just my heart sinks. And I go, oh, 100%. I say, you've got to give 110%. I go, I can't. I'll tell you what, I probably won't even give 100 because you never know. But I'll give as close to 100 as I can stand.
Yeah.
And that's all I'm. I'm saying that to a drill sergeant.
Yeah.
I'll tell you what, I'm gonna give nearly 100. And that's, you know, that's more than most, I think you'll find.
Maybe if you appear on Celebrity Fact Club.
Well, I don't think I need to, do I? Carl, do you think I need to go on that?
When you had your nipple out.
It was pointing downwards, was it?
A little bit.
Even though it was erect, it was pointing toward my knees.
Can I just, point out that we've had more requests for Carl to kiss your nipple than we have answers to Rockbusters?
Ain't gonna happen.
Well, it's the last show, Carl. You've got to give the punters what they want.
In the webcam, and just a little peck Ooh, on the nip. A little
Carl,
peck.
Carl, that is just out of order. The show must go on. You've got to give people what they want.
I'm doing it.
Why? Why not?
What's wrong with
lips on nipple? What's up with lips on nipple?
You hear about stuff like this, and then like I might enjoy it, and the next thing it's like, Suzanne, can you leave? Because do you know what I mean? I like fellas.
That's like an episode of Kilroy. Oh God. Oh, and
I'll tell you this,
Pilkington. Are you thinking?
I'm thinking exactly the same as you. I think I was reading the paper today. The show's been
axed. Is axed.
But they're keeping the show on at the same time. It's gonna have a different name, different host. Hello.
Pilkington.
Come on.
Hello, welcome to Pilkington. Oh, Carl, what would you do? If we give you a subject, will you just run through what you might say about it, or what questions are asked?
What sort of stuff?
Okay, sort of like, Steve's 15, I'm 15, and my dad wants to have a sex change. So I'll play the dad, right? I'm Jeff. I'm Jeff from Luton. I'm, a 54-year-old plumber. Oh. And, I've decided, and this is my son,
Paul.
Paul. Paul, you sure want to be Paul?
Yeah, I thought it would be Paul.
Okay.
Yeah.
So ask me some questions.
So what's going on?
Well, I'm not happy with this body. I've always felt that I was a woman trapped in a man's body.
Have you?
Yeah. Oh. Yeah, and, I just feel, I think I'd be happier, as a woman, and, you know, it's for him to accept it, really, because I'd have accepted anything that he wanted to do, or, you know, and it doesn't change anything.
Not
no, I know, but I mean, it won't change anything. I, you know, I still love you, and I'll still be your father.
I can't believe I agreed to come on national TV. I'm gonna get some taken out of me at school.
Really?
Man alive.
Well, you know, with that, you gotta go through lots of stuff, but I mean, don't think of me any different.
What does Mum think of all this?
Well, Mum doesn't want it really. But I mean, she I'm not gonna throw away the knob and bollocks, I'm gonna keep that for her in case she ever wants to use that. But I just don't want them attached to me. I'm gonna have them off, I'm gonna have some lovely pair of tits put on, and a nice little minge down there. But I'm not bent. Mm-hmm. I still fancy my wife and that, and you know.
Okay. Well, thanks for coming in today.
Yeah, brilliant!
That's your audition for Pilkington.
Well, what can I say? I'm not a doctor, right?
But what would you want? Come on, ask me questions. But what?
Discussions with me. I must say it with my dad because he wants to become a woman.
But say something like, well, dear, but you mean you've had a son and he's going through an awful lot. Should you think of him? Shouldn't you put his feelings?
Should you think of your son before you go doing that?
Yeah, but if I'm not happy with who I am, how can I live a lie? I'd go through my whole life living a lie just because he might go through a little bit of embarrassment. You know, he's old enough to realise now that you know I love him, and I just need to have some tits and a minge on me.
Well, thanks for coming in.
Oh Christ Almighty!
Well, what
play a record?
I'm not Rockbusters sure answers. Oh. Let's see Rockbusters answers.
Rubbish.
I don't want the gig anyway.
Like they were seriously considering him.
Thanks for coming in. Brilliant. Go on.
Did I tell you my dad's always been an asshole to go on that?
Why?
He's always been an asshole to go on.
Is okay, he a well. Is he a woman trapped in a man's
body? No, they want to talk about you. There you go. So right. Is it disappointing? Go on.
Anyway, Rockbusters, right? Right. First clue was Jamaican fella wrote a review for Phoenix Nights.
Yeah.
Right. That was the cryptic clue. The initials were DC.
Yeah.
What is it?
Come on, no, you tell me.
It's Define Comedy. All right.
Define Comedy.
It's a Divine Comedy. All right.
What is that?
Well, just
do the accent again,
Oh,
it's just Divine Comedy.
Why are you talking? Hey, hey.
That's
do it again, do the accent again.
No, doing it again, you've got the answer, it doesn't matter, let's move on, right? Second one. We should all vote for Paul Daniels, David Blaine, Copperfield, Great Soprendo, Tommy Cooper and Darren Brown. Why is that? ES were the initials.
Go on.
Elec, Trick 6. Right?
What?
Elec, Trick 6, it works, so don't say it like that.
I don't know what it means.
Right, well there's 6 people there who do tricks and that. Right, I'm saying we should vote for them, so you elect them.
Yeah, but he said elect.
Yeah, elect Trick 6.
No, elect though, elect's not a word, is it?
And the last one,
I don't think elect's a word, elect.
Steve.
You don't mean Alec, do you? It's not Steve. Alec Park. You're not trying to do Alec Park, the one.
Third one. Steve, what did your dad do?
I don't know.
That was E. Could work for anyone, it didn't have to be Steve, right? That was, Erasure. Right, Erasure.
Erasure. No, it doesn't work either. It doesn't work either. No, it doesn't work. Doesn't work.
Who's the winner?
None of them work. None of them work. Another pile of crap for the mind of little stupid.
I'm going to give the prizes to Martin Williams from Flintshire. I don't know where Flintshire is. He says that he's promised to listen to the Lord of the Rings, and by listen he means sell them on eBay.
Yeah.
So, thanks for coming in.
Stupid. The end of Rockbusters from the stupid little shitty brain. I'm going to say it. Of Pilkington. Possibly my favourite song of all time, after the Gold Rush by Neil Young, and that's for Carl's lookalike Boyd, who's actually on Justin Lee Collins' show after us. About 5.
He's not really a lookalike.
He is. Yeah.
He's got a bald head. Look like Gandhi.
well, he's in a toga, he does. A little bit.
I don't think Gandhi wore a toga.
No. So what are you,
What did he do?
Oh, dear. Well, he just sat around, to be honest, Carl.
Didn't want
to
get involved.
Didn't do much.
Just said, let's not, don't have a go, just be careful.
Yeah.
Don't go mental, don't start fighting, let's all calm down a little bit. He's the one in the pub that goes, okay, stop this, stop mucking around.
We were educating Ricky earlier, Carl, I wonder if we should resume that, as the clock is ticking away.
Alright, you've got 2 bits of info that you could be, leaving the building with today, right? You've got, where there's a will, there's a way.
Yeah, I have that one.
They've brought out this drug or, sort of tablet or something.
Yeah, you've got to do it then, yeah, go on.
Carefully researched.
Yeah, brilliant.
Which means, like, an 8-year-old woman can have a kid. What do you think of that?
No, it doesn't.
What are you talking about?
You can inject a woman with something, 80-year-old, and it means, you know, she's got more time on her hands now and that. It's better to have a kid. She can have a kid later on in life.
I just realised, where there's a wheel.
Yeah.
Very good. Very good.
Right, well, let's just move on from that, because he's clearly drivel.
No, it's not.
I think it's a bad idea. Of course it's a bad idea. I'll even give you that it's true and possible and might
no,
even-
it is true and possible.
Okay,
it's been, well, you know, it's not even recent, it's like a few weeks old.
Oh. Yeah. Okay. Well, it's terrible. No, you shouldn't do it, yeah.
Alright, what's the final educating Ricky? So far, I'm not impressed.
Get her a cat. Yeah, get her a little Pekingese. Don't let her have a child.
Yeah, but it's meant to get you thinking, like you're saying, well, she shouldn't have a kid.
Or, well, the time is five, she'll try and pick her up and her arms will break.
Whose arms?
Moving on, what's the next one?
Would she get a breastfeed?
Yeah, and she'd be able to do it standing up while he was on the floor.
Talking to nipples.
Hey, come on!
There's a lovely juicy pair over there.
Okay, I think this is the last show. People should actually phone in and speak to Carl and try and convince him.
No, forget that.
Yeah, what's the number, Steve?
We haven't got time.
Yeah, we'll do it during the record.
Leave it.
If you want to speak to Carl, if you have the number, call him, try and convince Carl to kiss a little nipple.
Don't want to.
Yeah.
Right, what we're doing, are we,
what's the last educating Ricky? Come on.
Hook, line, and good thinkers.
Brilliant. Okay,
yeah,
cool.
Sounds good. Go on, what is it?
They've found a lot of fish with two heads. What do you think of that?
Well, dunno. What do you mean they've found a lot of fish with two heads? Who has?
They've been messing about, basically, these scientists and stuff, and they've said, look at this we can do.
Mm.
And they're making loads of fish with two heads. Actually, they can do it now, and they're saying, that's good, isn't it? Do you know what I mean?
Alright, play record then.
Yeah, but what do you think?
I think if they can do that to fish, they should try and do it to you, and then at least you'll have two brains to work with.
Yeah.
And we might-
arguing. I'd love you arguing with yourself. And you end up just- you're walking on the street, but you're just head-butting each other. Just cracking heads
the squeezing
middle.
Fun you'd have, really.
I wouldn't know what to do. I'd bang them together. It'd be like one of those kanakas you strap at a playground on the string. I'd just whack them together. I hit your head on the window, didn't I, to see what the noise meant today, didn't I?
Yeah. What? Just if I had two heads, right? Would I be able to sort of do shifts? Do you know what I mean? Say if this is a start of something, they're trying it out with fish and that with two heads.
You'd be two different people. You can't think like you're one. It doesn't make sense. If you had two heads, you'd have two brains, you'd have, you know.
Well, that's alright, but say if we did the same job, well, we'd be doing the same job.
Yeah, you could.
So you could say, right, you work through the night.
You'd take it in turns to do your job badly and moan about it, yes, it'd be fine.
He's giving it some serious thought.
I know, yeah. And so's his other head.
Yeah.
But also, they're saying there's, like, a fish shortage, and I was wondering whether they're doing, like, they're trying to make that better. Do you know what I mean? So
yeah, well, as the head is a bit you throw away, it'd be perfect.
No, but when they do a head count like they do, that's what they do. They do like
they count fish. They get fish. But okay, just end the line. One, two. I think you'll find we're one, sir. Don't answer back,
Rick. I should just point out that I feel
don't answer back.
Come on, I think Carl has offered nothing there. I think those educating Rickies were appalling.
Who
and the
fish?
Only thing, the only thing that would redeem the show is if you kissed
the nipple. Because the nipple phone. If you want to speak to Carl, if you have the number, call in and try and persuade Carl while this record is up. Well, that's the phone. Phones are still going mad. Answer one. Just put someone out. Kings of Leon, California, waiting. He was rude. He's so rude to people. They phone up and they say, "Oh, kiss his nipple." And he goes, "Yeah, right." And he hangs up on them.
What
answer the phone.
To say to
put them on air. Answer the phone and be nice to whoever it is. Be nice to them at least.
Putting people on the air.
Hello,
Carl.
Yeah, speak to Carl.
What? Why don't you speak about that human monkey that was on the other day?
Old news, man. How long have you been listening?
Can we forget the monkeys? What do you think of his nipples?
All right, then, just kiss his nipple then for.
I'm not kissing his nipple.
I'd do it 500 quid easy.
Would you?
Yeah.
But why? What? Why do you want me to do it anyway? What are you getting out of that?
Oh, come on, mate. 500 quid. It's worth it.
Yeah, but.
You've got the money. You'll probably get more out of him if you want.
It's not about the money, really.
500 quid. Think of Suzanne. Suzanne, you'd come in 500 quid and go, there you go. Just don't kiss his nipple. 250 quid each.
She gives me more.
No,
I'm not. It's not happening. Right, it's not happening.
Did you just cut him off then?
Well, there's another fella there.
Who's that?
My name's Linda.
Right. All right, Linda, you all right?
What would make your day, Linda?
If Carl actually gave it a lick, not just a kiss.
Forget it.
If you're on XFM 104.9, pictures of you, and it's Ricky Gervais, Steve Murphy, and Carl Pilkington hosting the final show. Exciting.
Which means the last film quiz. Carl puts himself in a film.
Claire's on next week, by the way, and then, Adam and Joe.
Then Adam and Joe, brilliant.
Adam and Joe coming back, so that's
excellent.
Brilliant.
They're excellent.
Right.
Matt Lucas said he'd do a show. Give him a call, and maybe him and Dave Williams.
Yeah.
Big things of this, huh?
Might do that.
Yeah. Very good, wouldn't it?
Yeah, it'd be alright, yeah. Right, the film thing, this is when we get, like, a film, and, I'm in it, right? So I'm doing, we talked, you know, a bit about gay fellas and that today.
Yeah.
So we're doing, When Harry Met Barry.
Okay.
Alright.
Yeah.
And listen to this, and then there'll be a question at the end and you can win some more stuff. We've got DVDs
and that. Some more shite.
Some more good CDs and DVDs and yeah. that.
Alright, let's hear it.
So, When Harry Met Barry. Alright.
Mm. We've got 18 hours to kill before we hit New York.
Oh, yeah. Brought a few books just to kill a bit of time on the journey.
When I buy a new book, I always read the last page first. That way, in case I die before I finish, I know how it ends.
I read a book like that once. Not on purpose, though. It's just that all the chapters have been put in the wrong order, so it's a bit annoying. Got to chapter one before I realised.
Are you finished now?
Yeah, I bought another copy of it and read it in Lanzarote. It was alright. Good read. Listen, we're only staying in New York for a couple of days, aren't we? Because the place does me head in a bit.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it just stinks, doesn't it? It's a really dirty city. It's noisy. It's funny, the people who live there call it the city that never sleeps. I'm not surprised with all the noise.
I couldn't agree more.
Listen, I know you're gay in that, right? What is the attraction with New York for you lot? What? Because it is like the gay capital, isn't it? They all love it. Even that Rod Stewart song, you know, that Killing of Georgie, that was set in New York, wasn't it?
Yes, it was.
Yeah, well, that song was about a gay fellow, wasn't it, who moved to New York and ended up getting beaten up. Not a great advert for the place. You keep going there. Actually, I know why you like it. It's because it's because it's a city that never sleeps, isn't it? You look like going out late, you sort of run your life at a different timetable to everyone else.
Are you finished now?
No, I'm not being funny, I'm just saying. Just don't think you should live your life like that.
Why not?
Don't start getting angry.
I think I'm entitled to throw a little anger your way. Especially when I'm being told how to live my life.
Yeah, you're right, it is your life. And that's what I'm saying, don't be dragging me into it.
What?
Well, you know I'm not gay, so why did you buy me a butt plug for my birthday? I'm not gonna use it.
What do you want me to do about it? I take it back, okay? I take it back.
Right.
Wanna spend the night in a motel?
No.
Why not?
Because you're gay and I'm straight, that's why.
Why aren't you seeing anyone?
Well, I'm seeing Suzanne again. We only split up for a few weeks when she had that funny haircut that made her look like David out of Slade. It's grown again now.
She looked weird, didn't she?
Well, but forget that. Anyway, don't want to share a bed with you again, not after last time.
Oh, jeez, what are we supposed to do? Well,
this is normal, mate. Pull over,
all
forget
right,
it.
All right,
forget
don't
it.
You...
I don't want to talk about
how
it.
How was that?
Pull over. Just pull over here.
Fine, what's
there's nothing, yeah? I'll get a B&B. And by that, I mean bed and breakfast. Bumble and bollocks, as you call it.
Get
right?
One thing straight.
Not interested. See ya.
Oh dear!
Excellent.
Oh, little Carl Pilkington.
When Harry Met Barry, it's a classic film.
What's the what?
What song was I talking about? That you know.
Yeah, we know. What song? What song? Yeah, okay.
Artist
brilliant.
Will do. Or the song title. Whatever.
Yeah, okay.
Email only ricky.gervais@xfm.co.uk. We can squeeze in a tune, and then I hope.
Oh,
my
news.
Monkey news.
Oh, what tune have we got? How long is it?
3 minutes. It's a nice one, though.
Brilliant, brilliant.
Bit of Amy Mann.
Fantastic.
All right.
Red Vines, Amy Mann. We'll be playing now some of our favourite tunes, and after Monkey News, Justin E. Collins, we're going to leave you with one of our mutual favourite tracks of all time.
We won't say what it is yet.
We won't say what it is yet. It's a little surprise. Then Justin E. Collins is in with little Boyd Hilton, Carl's twin brother.
The answer to Carl's quiz question. Carl, what was the question?
It was what was the song that I was talking about in that,
I Met Barry.
Yeah.
With Billy Crystal, The Killing of Georgie.
Yeah, Rod Stewart,
Rod Stewart, and Stephen Farron from Essex Winds, another,
DVDs and stuff.
Right. Alright, well, this is the final one, play the jingle.
Oh, chimpanzee, that monkey news, yeah.
Right, well, this monkey news story, right, it's about, this fella. A couple of fellas in Texas.
Yeah.
Sort of running a, running a farm.
Yeah.
Right.
They're definitely fellas. Well, how tall are they?
Yeah, no,
can
no,
we just let
okay,
them
they aren't human beings. These two are human beings.
Time's against us.
They're running this farm and that. And, anyway, so they're outside getting the cattle. And he turns round, right?
He says, that cow's...
Couple of monkeys walking about. So he knows what's going on, right? Mm. So anyway, so it's in Texas. They don't know what to do with the monkeys. There isn't a zoo. It's fairly barren there, isn't it? You know what I mean? Not much going about.
Yeah.
So the other fella who runs the farm with him said, look, we need a bit of an hand. Right? So, said, let's teach them some stuff, and the monkeys were happy with that, because they were lost anyway, right? So they had-
They were bumming around, they were looking for work.
They'd hired a motorhome, they'd got out of their way.
Maybe it's like the Hulk, they were like Bruce Banner wandering around, going, I need some work. You won't get angry, will you?
So anyway, right, so they taught them, they taught these monkeys how to ride a horse, right? So they've both got a-
Charlton Heston's not gonna pop up. You're sure you weren't watching a video last night and thought it was a documentary?
They've both got a horse each, right? They've been given, like, a little lasso and all that.
Don't talk shit, Carl.
So, anyway, it's going well, and it carried on for about 2 years, this, right? It's, like, you know, rounding up the cattle over there and all that. So, the two fellas are chatting, going, it's worked out well, hasn't it?
Right, if there's a hostile takeover, and they sort of, like, buy up 51% of the shares
or
something.
For this to continue, the monkeys are getting old a bit now. We need, a little woman monkey in here to sort of get some kids going for, like, the future farm people.
Forward planning, yeah.
So they get a little woman monkey.
They decided to only hire monkeys from Ireland.
Why not? It's working. Why mess with something when it's not broke, right? So they get the little woman monkey in. They have kids and all that business, right?
Mm.
But the problem was, right, when they first got the woman monkey in, it was like, well, which one's gonna have the woman?
Right. Right?
So, they started sort of fighting a bit and what have you. But because they'd seen the owners of the farm with, like,
guns
and stuff.
Don't tell me the baby monkeys didn't want to go into the family business, one went off to be a lawyer.
They had a bit of a shoot-off.
Shut up!
They got two monkeys, right?
And don't tell me!
Because they'd seen the owners with guns and what have you.
No!
Yeah, that sounds possible. So they had a bit of a shoot-off. Yeah.
That's how they sorted it out.
And who won?
I think it was George. The one called George.
Right.
So I think they had 17 kids. The farm's still running. So that's like the last little monkey news. Good little
Rick,
happy ending to that one.
If you were to rub your nipple against his lips while I held him down.
Right, come off it now. Come on. No, I'm not doing
Bruce Springsteen, Thunder Road, last track on Next FM's with you, Steve.
I'm not trying to.
You can check this all out on the webcam.
Oh, no.
I saw I got fingers.
Get his arm out of the way. Get the arm out of the way.
This happened on scum.